Good morning, everybody, and welcome. It's the 7th of December. This is the meeting of the NHS Lancashire and South Cumbria Integrated Care Board. Good to see you all. Particular welcome this morning to those of you who've come to observe our meeting today. Thank you very much for your interest in our business. I hope you're warm enough and we'll keep going through the whole of the meeting. Particular welcome to Mike Thomas, who's the chair at University Hospitals Morecambe Bay. Mike's here for item 7 on the agenda and will join us at the table at that time. Welcome to Lindsay Graham, who's here. David Blacklock, who's normally with us as the participant member from Health Watch, is away. Lindsay's here in his place. Apologies from two members of the board, John Redman, who's here as a participant, as Director of Adult Services from Cumbria County Council, is unable to be here today, and the Vice Chair, Ibrahim Adia, is also away. It's our first meeting here. Continuing to do the live stream and recording of the meeting. So we have a different system. Rather than a microphone in front of you that you switched on when you spoke and turned off when you weren't, that was logistically challenging for many members of this board. We've now a situation where microphones in the middle of the table will cut the whole of our business and hopefully just focus on the contributor at that time, and the cameras are placed in different parts of the room to catch us. So we're hoping that that the live feed works well on that. I'm conscious, depending on the time that we get to, that Kevin McGee and Angie might need to exit the meeting before the end. Hopefully, we'll be running on time. I've not been notified of any new declarations of interest, but if at any point in the discussions of any of the items a member making a contribution feels in any way conflicted, or to make the board aware of a perspective that they're contributing from that we might not be aware of, then please declare that at the time. Of the minutes of the meeting of our last time we were together on the 2nd of November. Jeff, are you happy with the minutes this
morning? Very happy. Thank nice you. Minutes.
Jim, I know you've made one or two points. Are you satisfied that the amendments have been made? Thank you. Any other comments on the minutes, please? Okay, can we adopt the minutes as record of the meeting, please?
All the same, those, Chairman.
Thank you, Roy. Now, we've an action log after the minutes. One of the questions that came up that Tracy raised last month was about the vaccination uptake in the different ethnic communities. It says that we're including it in the performance report at this meeting. Maggie, are you going to talk about that today?
Sorry, David, I missed what you said.
The vaccination uptake in different ethnic communities.
I can speak to that.
I wasn't asked to speak to that today, sorry.
Okay, no, it says it's in the performance report at the meeting. David, can you pick that up?
Would you like me to take it now?
Yes, please.
So, first of all, COVID vaccination is very important, protective intervention, and particularly for older age groups. And there's been a further round of boosters, which many of you will have had in the over 50s. And obviously, it's really important that we focus on the older age groups, which are more vulnerable and more likely to end up being admitted to hospital. Across Lancashire and South Cumbria, the uptake of boosters in the over 75 age group is 78%, though that in care homes is 85%, the particularly vulnerable group. Now, that all looks very good, but of course the fact is we want to ensure that we get into some of those other ethnic groups, and that's why the question was asked. So if we look at the over 75s who are white British, it's 83% of that population took up vaccination. Those with Asian ancestry, 57%, Black ancestry, 55%, and Chinese ancestry, 63%. And that's consistent with the position across the rest of England. Even to get to those figures, there's a huge amount of work that the vaccination group has undertaken. They've got four dedicated working groups. There's the ethnicity working group. There's one for maternity vaccination, because again, there's another vulnerable group. There's a deprivation and isolation working group, and also a group for transient homeless and asylum working. And throughout the last few months, as the booster programme has been set up, a huge amount of partnership work has been done. There's a whole list of people here, but I think I'm just going to pick out a few, not just the local authorities and our colleagues in public health, the voluntary faith and social care sector that working with the Lancashire Council of Mosques, for example, the African and Caribbean Health Network, the Preston Windrush Initiative. So that's just to give you a flavour of the number of different groups that have been worked with. And much of that is activities going out and engaging with local communities. You can't do this by sending it out and letter or just kind of saying here's the offer. It's got to be done where you're communicating and understanding how to communicate. So it's been really important that they're understanding how locally we can engage with those local communities so they can understand the importance of those messages. They have to be tailored to that community. Just because Blackpool and Blackburn are deprived areas doesn't mean the solution is the same. So, and vaccination has taken place over across about 170 community venues. And I think the final thing to say is that we have worked with our colleagues in Health Watch, okay? And the Vaccine Programme has commissioned, with our colleagues in Health Watch, conversations with our citizens to help us understand how we can do it better. And we hope that we will see the report in the early part of next year.
Thank you, David. Excellent. Tees us up nicely for when we come on to the patient story citizen's voice item today. Right, let's get into the business of today then. Chief Executive's report, Kevin, please.
All right, so a few words. It's December, it's freezing cold outside, so I'd like to embrace the festive spirit, quoting the popular song, accentuate the positive, eliminate the negative. We face some big challenges. Winter is here. There's a lot of scope, we know, for doing things better. But I think I'd like to start by thanking staff across the system for delivering great services in very challenging circumstances. And I want to pay homage to some great examples in Lancashire and South Cumbria of outstanding innovation and high performance. Three ones I wanted to pick out: virtual wards. This is all about keeping people in the community and avoiding admission to hospital. We're rolling that out across the system. We have a very big program. By next Christmas, we'll have just short of 800 beds across the system, so very significant. We're achieving very high levels of occupancy in those beds. East Lancashire Hospital is our star performer, but they have been doing it for a number of years. The other three trusts are new to virtual wards this year, and I think they're doing really well as first-timers. So I think everyone needs to be congratulated on a high level of performance. The second area is chatbot. It's a virtual assistant for patients on the waiting list to check whether they still need to be on it or whether their conditions have changed and they need earlier attention. It was developed at Lancs Teaching Hospital. It's been adopted by the other three trusts, and it's actually being adopted in other ICB areas too, and it's made a real difference to the waiting list. So congratulations to them. And the falls lifting service. This is something, actually it was in the news this morning, about risks around the ambulance strike. NHS England are expecting all ICBs to have a fall lifting service as part of their resilience plans. And this is an area, actually in Lancashire, Blackburn and Blackpool, we do really well. We already have a 24/7, 365 days a week service. We do need to extend that to South Cumbria, and that is in hand. And it's all about reducing pressure on our emergency services, which is going to be critical at this point in time. One other issue to mention, our MARS scheme, the mutual agreed resignation scheme, we've had a good take up. We can talk to you about the details in part two. And final issue from me, register of interests and conflicts of interest. The NHS has a well-established guidance on registering interests and managing any conflicts, and we follow that guidance. But we have received a letter in November from the Chief Financial Officer that sort of effectively raises the bar in terms of those declarations. In essence, if it moves, register it. So we are now following that higher bar. There will be a report going to Audit Committee later this month, and there will be a number of new declarations as a result of that. None of them are conflicts, but there is that enhanced bar. And I think we've got training planned for the new year as well on this, so that all board members are fully up to speed with the latest guidance. So I've said enough. Happy to answer any questions, Chair.
Thank you. And many of the things in Kevin's report we pick up in more detail in the agenda items still to come. So I don't want to anticipate those discussions or get into them at this stage. But on, is there anything else anybody wishes to raise on this? Kevin, do you want to add any more about the operational pressures at the moment in the system?
Clearly, winter has formally started in the NHS from the 1st of December. We've now gone on to winter reporting, which includes a lot of reporting back to the centre and more central control in terms of performance. It's very busy, it's fair to say, across all of our provider organisations. That's both in terms of the emergency flow, but also the work that we're continuing to do to remove the backlog for cancer treatments and for elective recovery. I have to say I'm really pleased at the way the organisations are working together and the mutual aid that the organisations are providing to one another. So it's extremely busy. I think the other point I would note, however, is that there has been a lot of activity around the strep A and paediatric. There's been a lot of paediatric activity over the last week or so. So we're just watching that because we're seeing a lot of activity through A&E and then into our paediatric ward. So we're just going to manage that and look at that carefully.
Thank you, Kevin. Chris, anything you want to add?
No, I think similar within mental health, learning splitting, I think, you know, winter. But I think the joint working between the Trust and myself and David Fernley have met with executives from Blackpool and with Kevin's team as well around some of the joint work we can do to alleviate pressures within EDs for mental health patients waiting for long periods of time. So we'll take that forward over the next few weeks.
Well done. Thank you, Debbie.
Just a question about chat box, if that's okay, because I'm quickly Googling it, doesn't come up later, so hopefully I'm not breaking any rules when trying to Google on. Just I read it with interest and obviously really positive feedback. It's just some really practical questions from a patient perspective, which are around, do we understand when people are coming off the waiting list, why they're coming off, are they better or are they going elsewhere, and are we sort of considering that in terms of our planning? And also, those patients who indicate that they've got worse and they need appointments sooner, are we able to escalate them? I'm just thinking there's only one thing worse than knowing you need to be seen faster, which is telling someone in it not happening and you're feeling even worse about it. And it's, do we loop back? I'm just sort of reflecting myself, I'm reasonably IT savvy, but you would know it this morning. Do we sort of give people at the end of that process the option to say, actually, I've answered something wrong, I want to actually speak to somebody rather than going through an IT system?
So yes, with both of them, is that David? In terms of patients that are coming off, that we're doing a detailed analysis to understand the reasons why, and we're feeding that back into future planning. And then anybody who's identified who needs to be escalated, again, we're following that through on a one-to-one basis and patient information and contact with those patients. So we've built in, and that's the whole point of the chat box, you know, allows us to take patients off the waiting list and no longer need it and understand the reasons why. If it does need to be escalation, then that goes through a clinical review. So it's a really positive piece of work.
David, anything to add?
Many respects reinforce what Kevin said. It's very much that the staff are using that to support patients, so the patients flag issues. It's very much about ensuring that patients who are on those waiting lists are being monitored, and if things change, that action can be taken swiftly.
And Jeff?
Just picking up the strep A situation, there's a lot of activity, but my point is, I think I'm just looking at it. Well, some advice issued by the UK Health Security Agency on the 2nd, and I think what paediatricians do is very clear. And I don't think they've got a problem, but I think general practice could do with a little bit of guidance, because the guidance I'm reading there, it's a little bit vague, and I think there's massive anxiety amongst the public about their children, and I think if there's clear guidance, that makes the relationship between the GP and the patients a bit easier. Do a bit more specific.
David, is that something that you could pick up in communicate? Abdul?
Thanks very much, Chair. Just to pick you up on Jeff's point, really. I think Director of Public Health, really, across the region, have actually been in communication with the UKHSA. And there was guidance and a letter actually published and released for educational settings in schools and head teachers yesterday, and that's been circulated to all of our school settings. And clearly there is further guidance really around primary care as well within that, and we can certainly reinforce that really through our links with our PCNs.
It's the when do you give the antibiotics, because we don't want to swamp the community down person necessarily, and when do you do a throat swamp, because the guidance I'm reading says think about it, so in plain English says think about it, and think about it more carefully. It doesn't say anything more specific than that. That's my concern.
Yeah, what I'll do, Jeff, really, and is take that back to our UKHSA colleagues for the Eurasian Public School of International Conference. So let me feed that back into international.
Thank you. Okay. Lindsay?
It was just in relation back to chatbot. So if somebody else wanted to come in on strep A.
No, fine. Carry on.
Okay. It might just be in an accuracy, but in the Chief Executive's report, it refers to 22% indicate they require an appointment sooner, but in the performance report, it references 2%. And there's a big difference between 22 and 2, so I just wondered if there was some clarification on that.
We'll check it out, I think.
I don't know. I don't know if the report is talking about a longer period of time and there's a snapshot in what Kevin's offered, but we can offer clarity after the meeting.
We'll get the right number in the minutes. Thank you, Lindsay. Right, let's move on. Item 6,
patient story today, actually, I think is really pertinent to the two discussions we've had. So we've had an earlier discussion about vaccination, and what the story today is demonstrating is how we're working with our hard-to-reach and our hard-to-reach communities around vaccination, building on a discussion at the last board. But also, Kevin's report very much focused on some of the positives in the system, and I think Lancashire and South Cumbria have been an absolute exemplar during the pandemic for COVID vaccination, but particularly across all of the areas, how working with some of the communities that maybe wouldn't come for vaccination in a more traditional NHS way. So this is just one focus on a bus around Blackpool, but I think it's really important to note that it's one example. I know there was some very award-winning work in Blackburn. Lancashire County Council did a lot of work with their communities. So we're only focusing on one to bring out the story, but I think across Lancashire and South Cumbria, under the leadership of the Directors of Public Health and James Scattergood, that have been an exemplar and continue to be an exemplar for the work around vaccinations, and I think that plays out in the video today.
So we're Blackpool and the Far College in Bicester today. This is one of our locations that we use throughout the Far Coast to help deliver the vaccination service on behalf of Blackpool Council and Public Health England. So you have ourselves, FCMS, who work from an operational point of view to ensure the bus and the services are delivered. Blackpool Council are the driving force behind it to ensure that the service is put out there for the residents of the Far Coast, and then you've also got Broadway Pharmacy in Preston. They deliver the vaccination part of the service. One of the main reasons for setting up the mobile programme is to ensure that we go to hard to reach areas, so elderly people, people in deprived areas who might not be able to afford to go to the local GP to get an appointment, or even missing work to go to an appointment. We were able to provide a dual service, so on a weekend they can come and get COVID and flu all in one without having to worry about missing work to go for a doctor's appointment.
Well, hey, it's just one of those things, you know, you're at work, you get a flexible period where you can take some time away, and also the walking service is convenient for it. Yep. So I suppose I could have done the vaccine with a doctor, but again, it's just one of those things, there's a free spot in the day. I know there's a service here that I can use, so I just want to use that service. So I'll leave the GP for people that know that's what you do.
You didn't hear about children being vaccinated years ago, did you?
Because just tell you.
Travellers then didn't know where to go, how to go about it.
Didn't know nothing about it, didn't know what was getting put into them.
And because like, obviously the medical staff were speaking in posh words, that sort of thing, they couldn't understand. Yeah. They felt too embarrassed to ask what they meant, and it was just left.
Just left off then, yeah.
Yes, changed a lot. You find when that bus comes down for the COVID and the flu, people now, because it's explained more to them, because the National Health now are explaining, spending time with travellers and explaining what can happen, what could happen.
The side effects and stuff
like that. Yeah, that sort of thing, which years ago they were frightened of.
Years ago it was no explaining, just like on a jab, yes or no.
Yeah.
And didn't tell you what was getting put into your body, and then people's like, oh, no, case my children sick, or made yourself sick.
Yeah.
In September 2022, we've seen the autumn booster come out. Well, that's for 50 plus residents. We've seen 11,000 people, including 4,000 flu vaccines in that 11,000. So it's had a really good pickup.
Since December 2020, when we started the vaccination programme, we've actually vaccinated over 40,000 people.
I had a flu vaccine and a COVID vaccine. It was convenient. It was just there, and I was already in college doing it on my lunch break. So hard to go to a GP nowadays, it would just make everything a lot more convenient. Maybe if it was like a GP or a nurse practitioner or something. Someone that could give me advice on not necessarily conditions that I need a full blown appointment for, but something that I might just want to check in, if that makes sense.
So through the year, we've had the ear syringing service and the mini health check service. So what it is, it's a service that we'll get patients in that maybe want a mini health check, and we'll send the data up to the GP practices, so it saves them having to do that job. We log it onto their own systems, so it's nothing for the GPs to do. But our service, we were seeing over 150 people a day ear syringing, which is great, and I know other places struggle and have appointments, so it's having that, there's no lid on what we can do on the bus.
Yeah.
Thank you, Chair.
So it's very impressive, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You commissioned this one?
Yes. SMS is an out-of-hours service, basically, but based in Blackpool and surrounding areas. And I myself have actually used that particular bus service to have my booster vaccination about a month ago. Yes, it is a good service. And I think, Chairman, as it said on the video, enabling it to meet the hard-to-reach people, I think, is the important vital thing here. Not just for us for this meeting today, but for the people that are actually accessing the service, excuse me. And I think you'll find in places like Blackpool and the surrounding areas and other places in Manchester and South Cumbria, there's difficulties for people who don't have any transport, their own personal transport, or the bus services now aren't as great as they used to be. So I think it's really important that we're able to go out into those communities, out into those hard to reach communities and meet with the people and give them, firstly, as it said there, give them the information, because it's important that information is given to them on a one-to-one basis, and they can meet with people who can, give them that information and can also explain the vaccination process and the flu process as well. So enabling that to happen, plus the other services that were indicated as well, I think it's, again, it's, I think we'll know ear syringing particularly is difficult to get. I think some GPs now don't give that. We do that in some of our walking centres, but I think again, being able to go out to meet those people that can't access those particular services in that way is particularly vital. So I think it's a really, really good service. It's much appreciated in Blackpool. I've had a number of feedbacks from it from individual people and into our board meetings when the CCG was up and running. So I just think I commend it, I think, to people, and I think it's something that perhaps we should consider expanding in other areas throughout Lancashire and South Cumbria. Thanks, Jim.
Thanks, Roy. Well done. Got Kevin then, Jim, please.
Yeah, I think the work that Lancashire and South Cumbria did through the pandemic around vaccinations is really commendable. And it was really innovative in terms of some of the schemes and how we did that in terms of getting to reach different parts of our community. And I have to say that the leadership of Jay Scatterbridge was absolutely magnificent through that period. So I just wonder, how do we build on that and the lessons that we've learned from that for other public health campaigns? Because as Roy's identified, there's a lot of lessons that we could learn. We must make sure we don't lose that. So I think that feedback and the lessons learned is going to spike it.
Thank you. Very helpful. Jim?
Thank you. Yeah, it was very good, very impressive. But we've talked a couple of times about the need to standardise across the patch. And I don't know whether that's just in Blackpool or whether it happens elsewhere, but if it doesn't happen elsewhere, do we need to? And I imagine there's equally good schemes going on in other parts of the patch on this. And we need to understand what they are with a view, as I say, to standardising across the whole of Lancashire and South Cumbria.
Yeah. Thank you. Angie and then Tracy.
Thank you. I think what made this really successful is that combination of the NHS skill and the local community knowledge brought by threats to public health and the local authorities, which was something actually we all had a lot more capacity, ironically, to do in COVID when we were very focused on that. And I think there's a real opportunity with the place-based partnerships to capitalise on that. And that will start, I think, when we work through that environment, it will really start to bring to life some of the opportunities in these reforms and actually really help to crystallise for us the links between those place-based partnerships and indeed the providers, which I think some of us are struggling to see when we see the diagrams on bits of paper. So for me, it's about actually using the skills of the different actors and agencies available in this partnership. And I think we can use these as really good examples to build on. And actually what that does bring is maybe a sort of standard framework of offer, but actually it's deployed differently in each area and each community to reflect that local knowledge that we're able to bring.
Very good, thank you. And Tracy.
Thanks, David. It really builds on Andrew's point, but I just wanted to pay tribute to Barclays Medical Services as a social enterprise working in Blackpool and the great work that they do. And the connections they have with the communities. And also really great to see somebody from the travelling community speaking on that video, because it's really important that we understand from their perspective the fears around vaccinations. And I think that was captured really well. Just really building on the idea of partnerships, the BCFSE plays a crucial role in communities. And like Andy said, it's about that standardised offer, but understanding how it's actually delivered, probably differently sometimes in different communities, because we do have to be flexible around community needs.
Yeah. Picking up on that point and Jim's point about where there's best practice, how we get everywhere. Abdul, this is a conversation that the Director of Public Health have when you're all together.
Very much so, Chair. I think it's an ongoing conversation between our local authority, NHS, local partners and our community involved in sector organisations around communication. So we continue the communication, but we also actually continue to actually be mindful of offers within community settings in terms of how we work. I think as we move into the new year, I think we need further clarity, I think, from national colleagues around what the evergreen offer might look like going forward. We want to build upon the best of the last 2 years, as Angie and colleagues have actually described. It is a matter of the year around how we deploy our resources, best effect, really, but there's lots of opportunity to actually continue to actually work with our community voluntary organisations in particular, because they have the ability to actually reach and to clearly communicate with this population on a regular basis. So we do that with the community champions within Blackburn and Darwin, and we also do that really through our PCA networks as well.
Thank you. Well, Jane, we've talked about you as if you're not here. So about anything you want to add the last word on this before I move on?
Just that the experience of working with our partners to tailor a bespoke offer for each and every little community has been extremely rewarding and extremely productive. So a vote of thanks to all the partners.
Well done, Jane. Thank you. Excellent. Right, let's move on. Item 7, provider collaboration. We know for ourselves here as a board, we've been in place since the 1st of July. The part of the changes in the NHS and the way we work, we're developing the place-based partnerships, which Angie referred to and we've discussed here in previous meetings. We're establishing new relationships and new ways of working all across the system. The provider collaborative board is a crucial part of how our system's going to work. Our relationship as an integrated care board with the provider collaborative board will be key to the success of our patch going forward. And Mike Thomas, I introduced Mike for the chair of University Hospital Morecambe Bay, also the chair of the Provider Collaborative. Mike, do you want to come to the table for this item? I'm afraid I'm going to have to ask you to carry your chair with you as you come.
Thank you.
Thanks, Angela.
Would it be helpful, Chair, if I ask the Chief Exec, the lead Chief Exec, the Provider Collaborative, just to give you a context and then I'll tell you about why we're looking for delegated powers?
Of course, thank you. Kevin.
Thanks, Mike. Thanks, David. As providers, we've been working together in a collaborative form for many years, but formally for about 2 years now in terms of a provider collaboration board. And over the last few months, Mike Thomas has taken over the chairmanship of that board. What we're acutely aware of, however, going forward, is that we will need to be able to take decisions together that bind the organisation to those decisions, and we don't have to continue going back to each individual organisation to ratify those decisions. So that's always been quite technically difficult because of the issues around the statutory positions of foundation trusts. But in the legislation that was passed at the beginning of July that set up ICSs and ICBs, there was also legislation there that allowed the formation of joint committees, which will then allow providers to delegate decisions to a joint committee and hold those providers to those decisions. So we've been working in the background to set that up. We've taken it now through each of the individual boards, so that's the five main provider organisations, the four acutes, and the Mental Health Trust in Lancs and South Cumbria, and each of those boards now approve the formation of a joint committee. The reason we've done that, as I say, is hopefully that through the process over the next year or so, there'll be delegation of some responsibility from the ICS, which is that joint committee, and work that we're doing together around collaboration on clinical services for the future, on support services and how support services will look, will require that joint decision. So I think we see this as a really positive step forward. It's a real commitment that the trusts are not just thinking about their own population, they're thinking about the wider population of Lancashire and South Cumbria. And I think it's a really important step in terms of our maturity and how we can make decisions quickly and appropriately and the right decisions for Lancashire and South Cumbria. So that's the background, but I really ask for Mike for his take now as the chair of the provider collaboration.
Just to help with the contextualisation, Chair, the five trusts have decided that Lancashire and South Cumbria is our catchment area. So we're not anymore looking at
the trust has a geographical area. All of Lancashire and South Cumbria is shared by the five of us sort of equally. So a patient being seen at Burnley may very well have support from somebody from Barrow, or somebody from Blackpool may very well be seen by somebody at Preston. And that was the starting point for our discussions, really. We know through collaboration we can have a joint strategy, and that's much easier to implement than by single strategy, enhancing care of the population. We know we can meet population needs better if we work together. And you heard a little bit example of that earlier on when Chris was talking about how mental health can support the acute providers with their urgent care. The philosophical principle we've adopted is that physical care and mental health care are not separate entities. An individual with mental health needs will have some physical illnesses or discomforts, and anybody who's physically ill will know that they will have mental health needs as well. So we're taking that whole person approach. The other thing that we want to do is look at, as Kevin said, developing joint electronic patient records, joint patient pathways, joint patient referrals, shared urgent care and winter planning support, things around stroke care, coronary care and fragile services. So the joint committee, in effect, give us the accountability and governance framework that allows each board to delegate powers to that joint committee to carry out that work on their behalf.
Thank you. And Mike? I think it's a very, very good development, but this goes forward. Can you describe how the discussions in the PCB, how from there you think about the relationship with this board and how that's going to work in the best interest of the system as a whole?
We think that the accountability framework will be to this board. So the PCB will be accountable to this board. Obviously, the strategy we have will be the ICB strategy and the ICS strategy. It's not a monopoly that will go off and do its own thing. So we see that as a governance framework too here. That includes sharing resources, financial planning, strategy, place-based partnership work, etc. So we won't be separate to this board. We're conscious that the terms of reference that we're developing and has been approved by the board has to fit in with the constitution and your terms of reference of this board. So we would seek advice from the ICB to make sure that we don't have anything in our TORs that is at odds with that. And we see that as you develop your strategic five-year plan, that the provider partnership, the joint committee, will be there to say, like, what's our sense of delivery on that? And then how do you hold us to account to make sure we met those delivery objectives?
That's very helpful, thank you. Points, questions? Got Sarah then, Sheena.
Thank you, Chair. So really welcome. I think it's an important move forward. So I've just got a few comments and probably one query on the content of the terms of reference. So one comment is where it talks about approaches to service change, which I think is right, and you've just given us some examples. I suppose it's just making sure we don't lose sight of the fact that the statutory duty to consult on service change does lie with the ICB. So it's really important that the provider collaborative and the ICB work together on any significant service changes that come out of the joint working. And another comment, I suppose, was it talks about deciding at which stage to involve commissioners. And again, I would welcome that being clear that would be in discussion with commissioners about which stage, because I hate the provider collaborative to get so far on something and consult to commissioners and for some reason that isn't going to work with the wider system. I mean, eventually, you know, you looked at the legislation and the guidance as the bill was passing through Parliament, you know, commissioners may end up sat working in the provider collaborative. That's part of the way forward. My query was on where it talks about shared clinical services for community services, because we're just about to set up a health system transformation programme around community services. So I suppose I just wanted to understand that one a little bit more and making sure there's not duplication in there and that is part of the whole system work, because there's a massive role for community services around primary care and the fuller review. So that's not a provider collaborative specific piece of work, it's a system piece of work. And my last comment is actually relates to something you just said, Mike. I hadn't thought about this when I was reading the terms of reference. I think it's really right, and the geographies Lancashire and South Cumbria, we do have small but some significant parts of our communities that actually their main provider doesn't sit with them that provider collaborative. So immediately came to mind was the West Lancashire population. And I suppose it's thinking through how our provider collaborative is going to connect strongly with, for example, in that case, the Cheshire and Mersey provider collaborative, to make sure that we don't end up with gaps in terms of pathway flows, because what we do here is, if it's a stroke, doesn't fit with the stroke pathways and the flowing around for that Westlands population around Southport and Ormskirk. So that's something we just need to be mindful of, how we make sure those communities that live on the periphery of our geography that flow into other providers, that's connected up.
I'll collect a few points up, Mike and Kevin, and then come back to you to respond. Sheena next, please. Yeah, thank you.
I mean, I very much welcome this development, and I think this is a really important step in the evolution, moving away from competition to collaboration, and providers working together to make sure that we get the best outcomes for the population that we serve. So strongly supports the development. I think, as we've already said today, and Mike, you and Kevin, you articulated, this is part of a move forward. It's not the end point, because it's really important that that kind of working with place, as well as between providers across the population, is going to be really important to making sure it's the both. And I think the other bit is around the, obviously there's five providers there and there, but absolutely making sure that there's a linkage to other providers of health and social care, particularly when we think about the third sector and the opportunities there are as we develop and evolve. In this very different way of working, that we make that inclusive as we move through over time, but absolutely support. This is a really important step in moving forward, and that move from competition to collaboration in the interests of improving the outcomes for all of our population.
Thank you. Sheena. Got Roy, then Jim, then David.
Thanks, David. Just firstly to say I agree with points that have been made by both Sarah and Sheena, and thanks to both Kevin and Mike for that presentation. Some colleagues around the table will recall, certainly, that the CCGs had a similar programme in place, where we got together and formed a joint committee of the CCGs to make strategic decisions at that level, which, in my view, worked very well. There's one question I've just got that refers to the accountabilities, and I think Sarah's touched on the accountabilities, but it's about, the reporting structures that you have in place, and the issue on subsidiarity. And there's reference in there to subsidiarity, which is the right thing to do, obviously, making decisions at the right level. But who will decide where that decisions are taken, where those level of decisions are taken? Will it be the local boards? Will it be the local trust boards? Would it be the PCB who decided where that decision was taken? The position on that subsidiarity would be, and the reporting structure, would the decisions be reported back to each individual board through the minutes perhaps of the PCB, as it was at the CCG's joint committees, which I think is important. So it's really important that the individual boards can understand what decisions have been taken on their behalf, and I think perhaps in a timely manner. I think it's really important that they understand that those decisions have been taken on their behalf and are reported back to them, as I say, within perhaps that time limit. Thanks, Chair.
Jim.
Thank you. First of all, congratulations for getting this far. It's not an easy process, this, so well done. I think it's really encouraging. In one sense, this is sort of a bottom-up thing. Top-down, we're doing a piece of work outside of this room around, the overall accountability and governance of the ICB, and that work's been commissioned. We're getting feedback on it next month. It's just how that interfaces with this, and whether this needs to await the outcome of that exercise or not, basically. So whilst this makes absolute sense in isolation, there's another piece of work going on, which is how we respond, I guess, to the PCB.
Okay, come back, Kevin. Perhaps you'll pick this point up at the end.
Yeah.
David next, please.
So, Mike, I think this is a really great step forward. I think this is good for patient care because we are moving, as it's been heard already, from from providers who, prior to the COVID pandemic, perhaps were acting as independent providers and there was competition, to a position where, with limited resources we still have in the NHS, we need to look at how we can collectively deliver the best possible deal for our patients and our population. And by the providers coming together and agreeing to work in a collective way, and by having binding decisions, we can move forward some of the very difficult pieces of work we've got to do, which will be picked up in the cancer deep dive, for example, about how we ensure we have sustainable services for our population in the future. So I really recommend, think this is a great idea. My only question to you is, what is the next steps after this meeting to get this to move forward? Thank you.
And Jeff, and then I'll come back to you, Mike and Kevin.
Thanks, Chair. We're all about integration, aren't we? So this has got to be the right thing. And I think, speaking from the place-based development group, we'd very welcome this parallel development of the provider collaborative as we develop places. And those two things are key to mesh together. And we've just done some work on that in the last couple of days. So we welcome that. I think in terms of, we've got to think now about in terms of how successful will it be. And so we've got to think about how we evaluate that success, because that's what we'd want to see at the board, isn't it? And the prizes have to be the obvious things like better quality and better access and better use of resources, all that. But I think one of the things that will enable that would be better, improved clinical collaboration across the providers in the collaboration and with the clinicians at place, from provider to primary care provider to community provider. So I think that has to be one of your ambitions, Mike, that we see, because the collaboration is there and there's lots of good stuff going on, but it's not uniform and not quite where it needs to be. That's got to be one of the things that's different, I think, about an integrated care system, that we get there. We should all. So if we get that, I think that will enable all those. That ambition will enable those prizes of better care. So I'd like that being sort of something we look back out on from time to time and see if we're successful.
Thank you. And just before I come to you, Jane.
Sorry. I was thinking it when Jeff said it, and it's about evaluation. But to evaluate something, you need to know what it's going to deliver. Now, it may be chicken and egg this. You need this structure to enable quicker decisions of the formulation of a strategy. Or it may be that you know already what you wanted to do with that, and this is an enabling mechanism to make that happen. So I'm just curious whether you have that ambition and sense of priorities and deliverables that you want this to achieve that is above and beyond what you're delivering sort of independently, whether you have that, and I'm just curious to know this too.
A long list of issues for you to respond to. I've written them all down. If you miss any, I'll come back to you on them.
Comforting, actually, that all the questions you've asked have been discussed in quite a lot of detail, including legal framework advice. So that's good. One thing you've said surprises us. So I'll whip through them quickly, and then I'll pass to you, Kevin, on the operational side. You're perfectly right. We can't do any public consultation. Legal framework is that right for the ICB. The principle that the BCB has adopted amongst its senior leaders is no surprises, no embarrassment. So we plan things in advance, we inform, we consult, we take advice. So we recognise that any changes wouldn't be something that the PCB would discuss and then go, well, let's implement it. It would have to have a dialogue with the ICB. The danger, I think, will be around the executive groups. I think the strategy and the governance will be easier to manage, but it's who takes accountability for delivery and oversight and checking the outcomes. And I think there has to be a clear blue line between the executive workload in the ICB and the executive workload on the PCD. Otherwise, we will start duplicating work. So we recognise the public consultation issue. In terms of that, the TORs, going back to the question about being a look at the operational framework in the ICB at the moment, the TORs will fit in with the operational framework. They're reviewed every year, so we'll just adapt and change them so that it meets the legal requirement and the ICB framework. Community,
Yeah, we've got two subgroups in the PCB, very large, chaired by two separate chief execs. One looking at all the corporate side, so that's people, capital, estate, services, and one looking at clinical engagement and clinical pathways. The clinical engagement pathway one is currently developing under Martin Hudson, the chief exec of Blackburn, some device where we can talk to the place-based partnership, general practice, primary care, around those clinical pathways, because we've adopted the view that the acute trusts are not the end point for patients. We are actually the central point for patients. Patients come to us because they're ill, but then they leave us and continue with their life and require community support. So we're trying to get away from this old model of, as you get iller or more serious, you somehow or other get towards the hospital. We're thinking the hospital is in the middle of a circle of community care. So we have to work with all our partners. And yesterday we met with the place-based partners as a provider collaborative to see how we can develop that further. And there's people in the room that are there. Around the borders, there's North Yorkshire, as well as Cheshire and Mersey. We've got good relationships with them. And clearly through the clinical pathways and the clinical integration group, there wouldn't be anything done here that wouldn't come in either to the ICB and the NHSE. So that would be part of the early planning. So quite comfortable about the links there, really. Reporting to the boards, good question, right? We have delegated powers from the boards, but the PCB will be split into two agendas. One will be PCB general business, the other will be the joint committee business. The minutes always go to each individual board. So they're in their monthly board, and they're asked to comment, provide advice, and the chairs and the chief execs will be in that part. Subsidiarity is really important. We see it as a place-based initiative. We play our part in that. We haven't considered, and I don't think we will, that the acute providers would take on some role around subsidiarity. We see that's coming from the local population, the local authorities, the place-based partnership. What we would seek is, so what is the bits that you want us to do in that subsidiarity? We would not take subsidiarity role. That's something we've adopted. It's up to the local people and local authorities. You know, Ruth Connors looking at the operational framework. When that comes out in January, we will just adapt what we're doing in the PCB so it meets that framework. Next steps. I think the next steps will be to operationalise some of the priorities we've got, for instance, like the banking agency, and see what the effect of that is on care and outcomes and finances. Look at the financial planning of all five trusts together and see where we can share resources. Also look at procurement, see whether we can make savings on that. And we prioritise clinical pathways, things like fragile services, head and neck, primary care. And so we want to see where patients can go in things like reducing the waiting list in cancer screens. It might be that patients may have to go somewhere else, but they would be seen earlier. So we've got some outcomes and we've got some measures on that. Have I answered everything there, Chair?
It's a pretty good go, that. Yeah. Kevin, anything you want to add?
Just very, very briefly, Mike's covered most of the areas really, really well. Just in terms of the Ruth Connor and the Elworth and the operating framework, we would set up a joint committee regardless of whether that work was taking place, because we need to be able to make decisions together that are published together and make those decisions stick. So it's going to be very complementary to that work and support that work, but we do it either way and we would set it up. And in terms of sort of Jane's point, then in terms of priorities and or is something for the future, it's a bit of both. Some of the decisions that we know we need to take in the here and now will require a joint committee to allow those decisions to stick. But we also recognise that healthcare is going to change dramatically in the future, and how and where the concepts of healthcare will change. And we need, therefore, to be in a position that we can take decisions quickly and a very efficient way. So it's a little bit of both. That's all I've been.
Thank you. I'll come, Kevin, to you for the last word, and particularly on the operating model things. But just one question that came to my mind when you were talking, if I may, which is this. So some of the service change that we'll talk about, the addressing variation in access and outcomes, will lead to different clinical models, some of which we'll need to consult on for change and others. But for that, in the middle of that, one of the things is for many doctors, particularly surgeons who work for you, their working week will change. You'd be asking them to go to a different site or to do different things. So how confident are you that the clinical leadership across your organisations is, firstly, on board with that, and secondly, motivated to do that in a way which we've struggled to sometimes in the past?
I go first, Kevin, I'll pass you.
I always defer to you, man.
Dangerous. The indications in all the data sets that we've got so far indicate that there is the majority agreement of the way forward around joint work, joint committees, shared pathways, and addressing some of the past clinical needs. But I'm realistic enough to know, Chair, that the NHS has had 20 years of acute providers competing with each other. And so there will have to be quite a bit of work around information, advice, support, new types of inductions to change some of our colleagues. I suspect there will be a minority who will find it very, very difficult to adapt to that change. That's just the reality. But the majority so far around the clinical integration group, which I chaired up till the summer, indicates that the vast majority of clinicians recognise that this is a better care system for patients and families. So they are supportive of it.
I mean, when you cut through everything, our clinicians simply want to treat people in the quickest way in the best locations. And it's not acceptable that you might have a waiting list, say, of 50 weeks in one location, 30 weeks in another location, and becomes a postcode lottery. And they absolutely buy into the concept that we've got to have the highest level of equalised care across Lancashire and South Cumbria. And ultimately, the data always wins with the clinicians. So if you can provide the data in a way that they accept and they understand that data, they will absolutely buy into those changes. So it won't be easy, no change is easy. Fundamental principle of treating people quickly and in the right locations is absolutely brought into by all of the organisations and the clinical bodies.
Very good, thanks.
It's the daily things, Chair, that will irritate people. You know, when clinicians are asked to go to different sites and they have to have adequate car parking or transport, they have to have the right security to get in and not be turned away by a firewall, they have to have the right admin support for appointments. Yeah. The right clinics. It's those tiny little daily things that really irritate people. But that's our job to ensure that provision's there to make it smooth.
Good. So, Kevin, on the operating model point, Jim raised it, and others have referred to it. You know, as you sort of oversee the building of the whole of the system, how do you think this is going to fit in?
I mean, just as a precursor, I just want to say well done to everyone. I think it's a really big step forward and should be warmly welcomed. And I think as an ICB, we need to work with the providers to make this work really well going forward. And clearly a lot of the responsibility is with the PCB, but actually the ICB itself, you as a board have got some responsibility here. You've got high ambitions. You want to see transformation in clinical services, in productivity across our system, in community services, and actually this provides a mechanism to do that faster with less risk. So that's really, really important. We've got a really strong interest in this working well going forward. On the point about the operating framework, clearly there's detail underneath about, and Sarah raised it, about at what point do we get involved as a commissioner in all of that sort of stuff. and there are issues around how do we set objectives. And the answer in both is we have to work together well, but we need to understand that. But that shouldn't delay this happening. I think this we need to get on that. We need a collective way of making decisions. But we have detail underneath about the details of how we work, and we'll work that through with the providers. And I think Ruth should be completing her report in January, so it's not far away. And I would say get on with it, don't wait.
Okay, very good. Thank you. Well done, Mike. Well done, Kevin. We're cheering you on, and looking forward to working in this way going forward.
So if it's okay, can I leave the meeting?
Yeah. Thank you, Mike, for coming down. Chairman of Morecambe Bay is getting out before the finance report comes on.
They're doing very well.
Thanks for that.
Okay,
thank you very much, Chair. So what we've got in the pack is the financial position for the first 7 months of the year up to the end of October. I'm not going to go through the paper for two reasons, really. One, I'm assuming people have read it, and I don't want to just regurgitate what's in there. But secondly, there's a number of actions that have gone on over since our last board meeting. So much activity has happened that I'd rather really update you a bit on some of that, really. So I think just as a headliner in the paper, what we can see, we know we've got our 3.8 billion of resources for the whole of Lancashire South Cumbria. We're looking at the moment, at the end of October, at 62 million deficit at the moment. So that position, although it is a deficit, it has stabilised during that last month. And what we now need to do is reduce that, continue to reduce that as we go through the remaining part of the year. So it was reported at the board last month, we talked about the deep dive. So I think halfway through the year at month six, we decided to do a deep dive into all of the finances and all of the organisations to really get behind and understand what the drivers were that were causing some of the pressures that we've got in the system. That wasn't just into the providers, we did that with the ICB as well. And Kevin Lavery and myself wrote out to all chief execs on the 4th of November, which I think was around the time of our last board meeting, asking for a recovery plan back from every organisation by the 25th. And I have to say thank you so much to all the providers and to everybody involved and our own teams in pulling together what was quite a lot of work over a short period of time. What we found from the information in the deep dive, the pressures that are causing the risks that we've got to our current position, is really that, you know, what we can see is that we've had an inability to really close down things that were temporarily funded in previous years because of the pressures, the operational pressures that we see in the system. So things like funding that was given for elective recovery in previous years and COVID monies, it's been very, very difficult given the operational pressures that we see across the system to take out. So each board has been asked, and I know it's gone through all of the provider boards, each board has been asked to look at all the reasons and all the things that we could do and the non-recurrent measures that we could do to sort of achieve a break-even plan by the end of the year. So they were tasked to come back by the end of November. And I suppose it's also recognised that this can't be just a solution for providers on their own. There is part of this that absolutely everybody around this table, all of us have a role in helping work, because, you know, when we look at the acute sector, there's people in our beds who need services elsewhere, and the acute sector themselves can't do that on their own. So it's really important when we're talking about that architecture before, we get that right going forward as well, so that we can make the right decisions to think about the flow of our people through the system and where the right services are at the right time for the people that we're supporting. But there's two really important deliverables this year as we move through into the last quarter of the year as well and aim to break even. And one is that all the savings plans that everybody's had all year, they were calling them the SIPs, the cost improvement plans and the QIPs in the ICB. We need to make sure that we deliver those recurrently. Otherwise, we'll be starting next year with a big problem. And so it's really important. And what you can see and what I'm pleased to report on is that although we're not there yet, there has been a shift during the last month, and you'll see it in the paper that there's now sort of about 50% of those SIPs are recurrent in the paper. But actually, when you look at the full year impact, what we're seeing behind these figures is it's about 60% of those savings plans are actually recurrent, and that's growing all the time, and we want to see that keep growing. Otherwise, when we start next year, we're going to start with all of that coming back out. So there's that part. And the second part is this, what we've seen from the recovery plans coming back in is that there's been a huge amount of non-recurrent one-off temporary things that have been able to support some of those pressures I talked about before, because we're not shutting down capacity. We're going into winter. There's a lot of challenge in the system. But what we can see is there's a real opportunity to do things differently as we move out. But in the meantime, we're doing things non-recurrently. We've got to get behind those actions and turn them into recurrent actions as well, because again, we'd be starting next year with the pressures that come out of that. So I guess what we've seen nationally is the national team of and in Julian Kelly, the National Finance Director's report to NHS England's board that's just gone through, what we can see is there has been a funding sort of agreement for the next 2 years, an additional 3.3 billion coming in to fund inflation. And it's a standstill position really, because what it's doing is funding inflation, but it could have been a lot worse. So I think it's good that we've got that position nationally. But in addition, and we've touched on a bit of it this morning, is there's a social care fund of 2.8 billion next year, rising to 4.7, that's basically been secured to support better care fund, adult and children's social care, and flexibility around council tax. And there's a 2.2% efficiency planned in for next year. So where we are is, I think the providers and ourselves, a whole range of people, have worked extremely hard to take what was a risk of 177 million at the start of the year, down to a position where we're now looking, and in the report it says 70 million risk still. I think we're down to 55 million, and I think potentially we could be getting more towards 40 million. So I think the risk is in the right place, going in the right direction. But there's a huge amount of work to do that's been done to support that. I think there's a Get Well plan as well, led by our own executives for the ICB, to make sure that we deliver what is a risk in the ICB as well. What we've got, though, is to make sure, in terms of making sure that all of those things are done importantly, we need to make sure that we take a system-wide approach now to the recurrent plans, and that architecture we talked about is going to be really important to deliver this. So what we've got are real opportunities to drive out the costs now going forward through waste and duplication, through what we can see in terms of productivity that could actually be used to really sort of take some of the costs out without impacting patient care and without really impacting on the activity levels we've got. So these schemes that we've got, and there's five big programmes of work, and we talked about it last month in the board about the architecture around that, they now need to be going in place and starting to impact, and that will help not only with trying to close the final part of our gap towards the end of this year, but get us into that recurrent space going forward. And that's what's going to be really important, if that makes sense. So I'm happy to take any questions, but I think we're in a better position. We're not there yet, in a better position, but there has been a huge amount of hard work. And I'd just like to thank everybody, especially the providers, for the recovery plan, because it's not been an easy task. So thank you for that, and happy to take questions.
Thank you.
I suppose my first comment is, if we were just doing finance in isolation, I think this wouldn't be an issue. And I'm very conscious that we've got such a provider organisation, I've got massive operational pressures. But I am going to talk about finance in isolation now. So having qualified it, I know there's a huge amount of work going on, and it's great you've got the recovery plans. We need to see how realistic they are.
Yeah.
I guess this is just an observation, it's not a question. When you look at this, we've still got, I think, to me, there's like four ongoing issues. The running costs are continuing to increase, and until we kind of stem that situation, we're never going to make inroads into it. CIP is still well short of target. Within the CIP, as you said, the recurrent figure is too low. And I think closer to home, the ICB position feels like it needs more attention.
Yeah.
So the ICB's, our first responsibility is to balance the ICB's books, and that is in a not great position in this regard.
Yeah, we'll come back to you on this. I was going to pick up, but this ICB number has been sat at 19 million for 3 months, and it'd be helpful for you to tell us a bit more about how that's going to come down. Yes, please.
Yeah, so I think that there is a risk. There's about a £40 million risk in the ICB, and what we talked about last month was we called it the Get Well plan, but it's a sick, quick delivery and a number of actions that we need to bring that position down. The risk is high, but what we've talked about at the Finance Committee is taking back to the Finance Committee in January some real plans behind and some real sort of trajectories, milestones, and and deliverables against all of those risks to make sure that we can break even by the end of the year. What's making it very difficult to bring it down at the moment, because we've started off and we've been trying to reduce it or almost make a surplus to compensate for the first few months of pressure. What's been difficult is that, you know, we've got the significant pressure really in our position is around the packages of care, the continuing healthcare packages. They've gone through the roof, they're particularly high. And there was an assumption, because we were reviewing the sort of the backlog, that there'd be some savings behind that as part of our quick plans, which isn't going to happen. And on top of that, we've got the pressure. So there is a big area there that's made that difficult. But there's more work that we're doing behind that and more work to mitigate some of that, but also to carry on to drive that. Huge amount of work, I suppose, longer term, is the huge amount of work Sarah's doing on the CHC model of care is really important to this. And it's great work that Sarah's led on. But it's not criticism, but it isn't quick enough to drive some of these things right now, and that's why we've got some of those risks. What's going to be really important is that the Finance Committee get assurance of those plans, and at the moment you can't be assured, and I'm not fully assured that we've got everything that we need in place yet. So that they're all the schemes are there, but what we need to now see is the trajectory and the milestones to deliver that by the end of the year. So otherwise, because it is still a risk at the moment, and that's why we've not brought down the figure any further, because it doesn't feel safe to do that at this stage. But we're still aiming to break even with a number of actions that we've agreed as an exec team.
Are you involved in the medicines optimisation work, Jeff? Who, David, you are? Can you tell us a bit more about that?
So, well, we've got a new chief, we've appointed a new ICB chief pharmacist who's now taken on the responsibility. Part of the work is us obviously looking at how can we either take drugs which we can, which are cheaper alternatives, I mean, often they come off patent, for example, or whether we can, where people are prescribing overly expensive drugs, whether we can move patients across to drugs which are just as good, but a little bit cheaper. Okay?
We've been working on this generics thing for 20 odd years, haven't we? We still wrestle with it.
You'll never cure it. You have to keep working on it, right? My advice would be.
But we have made massive savings.
Savings last year were in the order of 20 million. It's a bit more difficult this year, partly due to the fact that, unfortunately, the cost of medicines, which are priced often in dollars, have gone up. So we are kind of swimming against the tide on this, but nevertheless making determined efforts. We've got our friends in MIAA involved supporting us with that to understand what are the opportunities we may have.
You've got to constantly have new patients with new drugs and new doctors and other prescribers. So there's going to be a continued drive to raise the costs and lower the quality unless you have an ongoing programme over the time.
Which is what we've got.
Yeah.
Okay. Other points on this paper? Roy.
Thank you. Sam briefly mentioned the Better Care Fund in a report, Chair, and next week it's the Blackpool Health and Wellbeing Board, and there is a report going to that on the financial monitoring of that Better Care Fund. Now, I know colleagues will be aware that the plan for the Better Care Fund was jointly signed off by the upper tier authorities and the ICB, and you will know about this, of course. My understanding is, in reading the report which I've read, which is going to the Health and Wellbeing Board next week, is that the Better Care Fund plan for 22-23 has not yet been signed off by NHS England, but apparently that's pending. But the interesting thing that I read in the report was there is an addendum to the Better Care Fund and the planning template, and that's with regard to Adult Social Care Discharge Fund. And that which is being distributed through the Better Care Fund itself. And this funding will be provided in two tranches. And the first 40% of that is in December. And the second 60% by the end of January 2023. I think it's really interesting for us as an integrated board to hear about these particular issues that are coming up and coming to the Health and Wellbeing Boards. I think I'd be interested perhaps to know if we get feedback via the Health and Wellbeing Boards, you know, through Sam's, I say, referenced it again, and I'm sure Andrew will know more about this than I do, but I've only just read this report. I know we have a Section 75 agreement that underpins the Better Care Fund plan, and that's actually had to be revised, I think, by the councils due to the changes within the Health and Social Care Act. I think I just reference back to that Social Care Discharge Fund, which should interest us all. And I think if that is coming back, perhaps it'd be interesting if we knew about that, Chair.
Yeah, thank you. We do make reference to it in the finance part of the of item 11 here. It's in the paper, the surge planning one.
Yeah.
And the there's no Cumbria authority on it, but the money that's going into the authority. Roy's question, I don't think that's what you were going to talk about, Angie, but tease you up to talk about how this looks from your perspective, please.
So actually, it's a similar sort of question. So I was just going to ask just to elaborate for us as a board, because she mentioned the social care funds. That's really important for the integrated care system, but we're not looking at an integrated care system budget here. We're looking at the NHS element of the budget, which is the point very much that Roy's making, and as we mature we need to think about how we start looking at the whole system budget, but perhaps that's not the immediate issue. Kind of what I wanted to just hear a little bit more from Sam is about the work that's been going on with the upper tier local authorities in this respect, and also then how we can guard against cost shunting. Because there's lots going on, and in our individual elements where we have different accountability streams for balancing out budgets, you know, it's very easy, isn't it, to cost shunt or to make a decision where we're not fully aware of the impact on our partners, and time's tight for all of us. So I'm pretty confident there will be some unintended cost shunting in all of our budgets when we set them. And we have to have a mature partnership conversation. But if perhaps Sam could give us a bit of a flavour for the conversations that have been taking place between the partners, that might help to reassure. And I don't know about every health and wellbeing board, Roy, but certainly in the county council one, it's vice chaired by a member from the NHS.
Thank you. Yeah, so we are obviously involved in all of the health and wellbeing boards through the executive team. And last night I was actually with Abdul in the Blackburn Health and Wellbeing Board, which was really, and this was on the agenda as Roy described. And it's a really important part, because this is part of the £500 million that's been made available coming out to us all through the Better Care Fund. What we're trying to make sure, and it was really great to see in Blackburn last night, the schemes against that really help the acute sector and help us as a whole system. And I think we need to do more of that. So Heather and I have set up meetings, I think, with all of the chief execs and the directors of finance to absolutely make sure we don't do that cost shunting, Angie. It's really important, because that could happen. But I think if we're tied together on this, and then we go back to the point I was making at the start in my report about providers can't do some of this on their own, we need to look at the whole big picture and how all this fits together, and we need the architecture to do that, then we need to make sure that we're fitting this. So those conversations are going on between Kevin and ourselves and yourselves, but also making sure that we're linked into those health and wellbeing boards. I know in Lancashire you've done a whole review, you had a very good day, I believe, with lots of people around the table, including health, looking at the Better Care Fund and how we use that better and how that can drive some of our agenda. All of this needs to underpin our strategy, and that's what's going to be important. So coming back to the planning part, through Maggie's leadership, from the health perspective here, we need to make sure that all these parts are connected through the planning, so that when we're putting a 10-year plan and a 3-year budget, this is totally integrated and not shunting from one place to another, as you say.
Sarah, then Jane.
Yeah, a couple of comments. I mean, on Blackpool, so I'm the executive rep for the Blackpool Health and Wellbeing Board, so I am at a meeting next week. On the cost shunting, I completely agree with what Sam said, but I suppose to what Angie said, CHC is probably the area where you can get this unintended, because the reality is, when we review CHC, if somebody's no longer eligible for NHS-funded care, but they still have care needs, often that then is a consequence for our local authority partners, or can be. And that's why, you know, the model that we're developing is very much about an integrated model and about shared budgets around this, because I think that's when you get the most effective joint working. So it's important, I think, Angie's point that, not intentionally, but the whole way, particularly care packages work, you can get that unintended if we don't work together, but we have been working together on the model. But that doesn't mean there won't be some savings for us, could be a cost implication from local government, and similarly, if local government are doing reviews, savings for them can end up as a cost consequence for the NHS.
Make it a point
so yes,
that
please.
All of the board are aware on continuing health care, because of the way social care works. Very often when the cost comes to us, actually it gets passed on to the patient themselves. They have to bear that. Mm-hmm. So I just want people to be aware, actually often it goes straight through to the patient.
Thank you. And James?
Yeah, just on the back of what Angie said. So I'm the vice chair at the Lancs Health and Wellbeing Board. And actually, in the last meeting before the workshop, we had a specific conversation about safeguards of cost shunting. So I think we're very, very mindful, particularly at this time of year, as we're looking to set budgets for next year, etc. But it's something we've got to work really hard against, because it's a really sizable risk. And I think in the Lancashire one, we're doing pretty well in terms of being quite transparent. I think we are in all of them, but we probably ought to make sure that when we come back with financial reports, we give some specific assurance on that point to this board in future meetings.
Thanks, James. Very helpful. You might want to pick this up in the performance and the winter surge item, but with a system and a set of organisations, as we've seen in this report and in previous discussions, in which expenditures in excess of income at the moment, it was a bit of a surprise to me, but a very welcome one, in the autumn statement and the budget announcement, of this extra money. I know this is a generalisation, but are we spending the extra money on new things, or are we using it to offset the existing overcommitments?
So this builds on and expands, so it is new things, because it's actually, so it builds on the, what we had previously was a hospital discharge funded, so it was non-recurrent, and then we've been given this half a million. What we've been told through the regional director of finance is that we need to be thinking of this as recurrent now, so it makes it recurrent, but then builds on it. So this is going to be funding that we can use in a different way, which should give us real opportunity to unlock some of the things that we've been talking about. I think it's really exciting. And actually, at the Health and Wellbeing Board last night, one of the questions that was asked, really, we have a lot of voluntary sector representation there, and it makes it really real and tangible about the role of our place directors and the role that they can play in helping integrate all of this and use this funding to make a real difference. And I think that's why some of that architecture is important.
And Kevin, please.
Just to build on what Sam was saying there, when you boil it down from a provider and a key provider perspective, I've got too many beds open that are not funded and it's staffed by agencies and bad that we're going to approve and support. And it's because there's not the capacity in the outer hospital system to allow us to discharge patients appropriately. So if we can use this funding and then better care fund, etc., in a different way to build that resilience out of hospital, it will allow us to discharge quicker. It will allow us to reduce that infrared capacity, and it will take the premium rate that we pay the bank and agency out of the system. So we'll actually get a significant cost saving, recurring cost saving as a consequence. And that's the way that we have to tackle the overall financial problem in place.
Okay. Kevin, anything you want to say?
Yeah, a couple of things. First of all, just to come back on the discussion around the ICBs, Eric, we can't have a deficit. We're not allowed to have a deficit. So. And we have got significant risks, as Jim said earlier, and we're going to get in the coming weeks some targets from NHSE on running costs for the ICB, i.e. they've got to come down. We're all over this as a management team, and we're making serious inroads into that risk. That risk is coming down significantly. We've got the MAR scheme, we've had some voluntary redundancies of senior staff, that's been approved now. We've frozen all vacancies. We're looking very carefully at the trajectory on all grant programmes across our system. We've got a really tight grip on discretionary spend, so that risk is coming down significantly. We've got to look at this year and where we end up, and the recurring position for next year as well. We're also in negotiations with our CSU friends, which are a significant part of our running costs, and we're making very good progress in those discussions. And I think what I was really pleased about recently when we did the deep dive with NHSE was we got agreement from our providers to a similar approach there too, with some, you know, tight grip on, I think they call it, grip and control is the phrase that's used. The application of a vacancy factor for non-clinical staff from next year, which will deliver a very significant recurring saving to the system as a whole. So I think it's still lots and lots of challenges, but I, you know, to return to my theme, there's some real positives actually as well, and the numbers, the risks are falling, and that we're moving in the right direction, and there's a lot more to go too.
Thank you. Okay, where we are, progress being made, still an anxiety, I think, in the feeling about where we're going to get to at the end, but we note the good progress that's being made, and again, support the continuation of all that work. So, well done. Let's set that now against some of the current performance challenges and where we're at, please, Maggie.
Thanks, David. And I think your last words there about progress but fraught with anxiety do very much echo the sentiments of the performance report, which I'll take as read and just add a few comments before we open up for questions. We weren't expecting to see a peak in our improvement against performance this month since we last met, but we do continue to see some marginal progress. Particularly around our 78-week waiters and our long cancer waiters. Performance is scrutinised and monitored throughout the month, both on a daily, feels like hourly perspective on some days. But we've got our own local trusts that monitor their performance right up to their trust board. We've got our provider collaborative board that monitors our performance, and we've got our ICB and regional performance meetings. And to come to a point that Mike made earlier before he left us around ensuring that we're not duplicating, we are really careful not to bring our staff to talk about performance to give us comfort, because we do need to hold our nerve on our improvement plans and let our good staff get on with doing some of the doing. All of our improvement in performance across all of our standards are predicated on improving our productivity, David. And you mentioned some of the use of the winter money. What we're absolutely determined not to do is throw money at a non-productive area or service. All of the conversations that we're having with our regional colleagues is bringing us back to an absolute clear use of our staff and our other broader resources. Broader work out into primary care with our clinicians around appropriate referrals. And then once a referral is made, that we've got really good productive use of both our outpatients, diagnostics, and theatre utilisation. And that is an area that when we go into the new year, myself and Kevin will want to bring more information to these meetings. So where is the variation? And Jim, this is something that you've talked to us about in previous meetings. Where is the variation? We've talked about virtual ward earlier in Kevin's report. And how can we
hold on, everybody. So this is an expected alarm. If it goes more than twice, we're through the door at the back. If it's twice, it's just the test. Should have said that at the start of the meeting. I
yeah.
Apologies for any anxiety. That was
usually, when I was in my old job, when I started my performance report, the helicopter would arrive. So I'm quite used to being interrupted. But we will want to bring back, as we get closer to the variations across the providers, What are we doing about that? Now, the variation is as complex as has been referred to. I think David mentioned this earlier when Mike was in the room, about who does what and where is it done across our system. And as we get into hearing more from that committee in common and from the provider collaborative work, we will be bringing some of those more strategic issues about provision to future meetings. But we are not trying to buy our way out of a problem. We are trying to ensure that we are one of the most productive.
Okay, still sit tight for now.
We are one of the most productive and efficient NHS systems in England. We have got good monitoring processes in so that we can pick up on changes in the trends and we can take appropriate and timely action. And as I've said, we do not intend to set up as an ICB alternative performance frameworks that will pull our people away to even more meeting time. I'm really pleased with the support that we've been given by our Get It Right First Time teams. And under David's leadership, we are seeing a change in a national/regional approach to GIRFD, and we're seeing that being more consolidated at local level. I've had a number of conversations with both national and regional GIRFD colleagues over the last month, and again, that all feeds into some of the productivity work that we're going to be taking forward. We've also, in month, myself and Kevin, supported by Kevin Labrie, too many Kevins, been working on a provider collaborative innovator bid. Nationally, there have been invitations sent out across England to ICBs and PCBs to become innovator sites. We feel that that would be a great opportunity for us because it will give us the opportunity to learn from the best practice that's going on across England, but also, which is becoming more obvious, how do we share some of the work that we're doing? And Kevin alluded to before around how this PCB has been working over the last couple of years. And when you look at our performance, even though we've got ambitions for our performance to improve and for access for our communities to improve, when you look at our performance against some of our local neighbouring ICBs, we are holding our own very well. In fact, in a number of the metrics, we are a leading light for the Northwest. We want to improve and consolidate that. I don't believe it will be a distraction from the delivery element. I think it will help us consolidate and expedite some of that work. That's probably the all I wanted to say as an opening remarks to the performance report. And I know we'll come back to councillor questions when we get into the deep dive. But I know myself, colleagues, Kevin, we're happy to take questions on the report as it's written.
Thank you. Before I open up questions, Chris, can I come to you? We discussed a couple of meetings ago. In fact, Sarah introduced the issue about health checks for LD patients, and there's a good analysis in here. Could you just give us your overview of that and where we're at and where we're going, please?
Yeah, so I think on the page you can see that there is variation in the delivery of that. I think there is one thing that from a mental health and LD&A trust that we can support with the teams that we've now got in place. We've now got fully recruited into the learning disability teams, working with primary care to ensure that we've got these checks. I think what we need to do is, when we talked earlier around vaccinations, COVID vaccinations, we know that this cohort of our population were really impacted by COVID during the pandemic. And it's been created that whilst we're going out and we're vaccinating our population that have got learning disabilities, that we're also looking at primary care and health care at the same time and trying to be creative with that approach to make sure that we're really using resources as productive.
Is the variation on this, Kevin? You know, we talked earlier in this meeting about best practice across the whole of the patch, learning from the variation between 30.4 in Chorley and South Ribble, and 14.3 in West Lancashire is almost inexplicable. You know, when these sort of things come up, our focus should be how are we, what are we doing, and how are we addressing that?
Yeah.
Sarah.
I completely agree, and whilst there's an important role for the trust to support that, that is fundamentally a primary care responsibility. And I think for me, what's not clear in the paper, that probably David and I and Jeff need to go away and just tease a bit more, is how do we get those practices in those areas really, really making this more of a priority? Yes, the trust can support and put things in through the trust that help, but this is a core primary care contractual responsibility, and if they're not doing it, we have to push with them a little bit harder on that.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is the area that we can shine a light on that otherwise wouldn't be shone anywhere in the system, and it's important that we react to that. I've got Jeff, then Debbie, please.
We've been watching this for a while, haven't we? And I don't do these checks personally in the practices I work with, but I refresh myself, familiarise myself this morning, actually, with what it involves, and it's quite a task. So we need to bear that in mind. The second thing to say is the variation just isn't between different areas. Within an area, there's quite a lot of variation. I know from my own area that there's very significant variation between practices within one area. So it does beg the question. And I suppose, it's similar to what Sarah just said. What I don't know is how general practice as a whole feels about whether they can achieve this and what they feel are the blocks or what they need to do. I don't know. I don't know if any of us have got a handle on that, but I would like to know that and understand it from the people who are supposed to be delivering, you know, so we can then help tackle it.
And Sheena?
I think Debbie wants to
say. Sorry, Debbie.
Yeah, no, it's okay. I think for me, the statistics are shocking up in terms of the variation. I start to worry about the accuracy of the register. I'm honest, and I know that we're doing work around that, but I still worry that if we're not absolutely sure that we've captured the full volume of young people who are entitled, not wanting to be pessimistic, it could actually be worse than we think. So that work to actually make sure that the register is accurate is really important. I think as well as working with the providers and looking at opportunities where these young people are to sort of scoop them up, the other thing that's really important to do is to raise awareness amongst parents that it's available and that it's a right and the value of that as well. So I'd like to see us do more work around that, because that will then pull out that provision as well. Obviously what we don't want is the patients or public having to advocate for this. It should just be made available, but actually it's a really powerful group of parents there, and if they know it's there, they will actually encourage the through, which would help us to tackle some of this.
And Sheena?
Yeah, so David, thank you very much for picking that out, because it was my first question. So I think one of the things that we absolutely need to do is to say, do you know what, we can't keep looking at this and saying, because it's one where we know that it does, we need to really pay attention to, so this is an important way of improving outcomes for part of our population that unfortunately have had significant challenges through the COVID period in all sorts of ways, not only physical but mental health. So I think it's somewhere where we need to really pick out why is it so much, you know, getting the variation even within an area. Why? What is the effectiveness? What is happening that's really making a difference? And then I think it's where also, David, if we can be very clear about the accountability, and I think that absolutely has to start going into places, because that's where places can work together to actually understand that. And Debbie, great point about for people with lived experience, because actually bringing those people into this, and as you say, making a partnership and understanding of that, I think will really, really help. So thank you for picking that one up, David.
Craig, welcome your view on this.
Absolutely, and I couldn't agree more with Sheena. I have experience of looking to increase our uptake on these health checks, and I think there are some things we can fundamentally do that will make a difference quite quickly. So with, I think, the new Directors of Health and Care Integration in place, we can look to see what some of the root cause analysis to find out a more richer data set to understand the issues, as Sheena has pointed out. But I think some of the solutions to this are, with our clinical lead colleagues, looking at supporting primary care and in previous roles, we've actually had dedicated clinics that look to then get larger number of individuals assessed rather than the routine sending out requests for assessments and then expecting people to come to surgery, having a much more targeted interventional approach at scale across different places. So I think there's probably a further conversation to have with David Levy and our Directors of Healthcare Integration in the places to look at what a tailored interventional approach would be, because I think Sheena makes a really valid point about we can't just keep looking at this, we've got to take some action to improve the uptake. So I can help facilitate some of those conversations and look at what interventions we can do quite quickly to try and improve this position.
Okay, so there's a bit of work to do in the execs. Then can Sheena and Roy with the execs have a discussion about how between the quality committee and the performance committee we can understand the action that's being taken on. Is that all right, Kevin? Yeah. David, did you want to come before?
I was going to say that I think Craig is quite right. We need to do it collaboratively together, but I'm very happy to be the executive lead to respond on that.
Thank you. David. Yes, Lindsay.
Am I okay to come in at this point?
Yes, you are.
Thank you very much. I think it's really important to note the significance actually of this data and the links to the LEADER, which is the investigations into the deaths of people with learning disabilities. And there are links in the national findings that people aren't getting their annual health checks. So I think it's a significance. It's not just about people having those checks and us improving the numbers. It's people's lives that we're talking about. And I think there's something as well that, so there's an offer. HealthWatch would really like to be involved. We are doing some work. We have some brilliant links with local self-advocacy groups and Lancashire's Learning Disability Partnership Board. But alongside that as well, there's something that we hear about quite regularly is around the application of the accessibility standards and the information that people are receiving about their right to have an annual health check, which comes from Debbie's point. So I think, that's something that we really need to think about as well, a standardised approach around how we provide people with that information.
Very good, thank you. Okay. Got another question. Is that all right? So, on moving on to waiting lists and times now, and I'm looking at page 7 of the report and the charts in 243 and 244. And this is a question coming back to a discussion we've had here previously. Abdul joined in others about inequalities and how we ensure that in addressing the elective backlog we don't wind inequalities. So what this tells me, correct me if I'm wrong, I am sometimes, 243 tells us that the total number of people waiting is going up, and over time if that keeps going up, both the mean and the median waiting times are going to go up. There's nothing we can do to change that. That's going to happen. So wait times are going up. Then we look at 244, and we see that we are making, as we're required to do, great progress on the longest waits, 78 weeks. The number's coming down. We think that we've got a target hit by the end of March. But at the same time that the 78-week waits are going down, the 52-week waits are significantly going up. So there's a big bulge. In an increasing list, there's a big bulge at 52. How underneath all of that, and then our attentional shift, how underneath all of that, the dealing with the longest waiters, the creating of a bulge, knowing that mean and median weights are going up, how do we keep an eye on the inequality issues in the incomplete pathway population in that context? Do we do that, and if so, how? Kevin.
So in terms of that overall bulge, we should be aware of that bulge, and in terms of our focus and work that we're going to do, there's currently a focus on 78 weeks, the very complex patients, which is taking up a large amount of time. But those numbers are coming down. 78-week waiters will be eradicated by the 31st of March, and most of the very complex pathways, we will have them in on the basis of equilibrium. That will then allow us to really focus on those 52 weeks and then we'll start to come down. So we're really clear of the trajectories and the work that we need to do. Now, within that, we do stratify the waiting list, and we are very clear in terms of the various characteristics of people on the waiting list. We're also now learning from some work that's particularly gone on in Coventry and Warwickshire about how they've changed the waiting list and the shape of the waiting list by pulling particular groups forward with particular characteristics. We have to be very careful with that and how we manage that and what that looks like. But we're monitoring very carefully the work we're doing in Coventry and Warwickshire. And if that seems to have an impact in a positive impact, it's work that we can put into Lancashire and South Cumbria. So we're absolutely aware of it, David. We're focused on it. We haven't got a solution to it yet, but we are looking at good practice elsewhere in the country. And if that is appropriate, we will bring it into Lancashire and South Cumbria.
Okay. And just on this, I'll bring us in on this point, far through, Asim. Are our information systems good enough for us to understand what the impact of the longest waits are and how that's impacting upon access for everybody?
I think definitely we have the information. And we have a thorough of information in different systems. But it's about joining these data sets up and understanding sort of the makeup of their waiting list. So your point around the stratification is a really good one, Kevin. It's what are these waiting lists made up of, and are there any specific risk group of people we need to look at first? So there's loads of information behind this, which the individual provider organisation will be looking at as part of their performance framework. But there are some issues in terms of capturing data. So if we take some protective characteristics, we know in a couple of our trusts, their protected characteristics are not recorded to the level they need to be. And that is due to some of the immaturity of the clinical systems that they have. So to be able to answer that question, we need to record that data in the first place. Yeah. And so there are some issues there that the provider organisations are working on for their electronic patient record system. So there is information, but there are loads of gaps within some of the way we record the protected characteristics that will maybe hinder us in terms of us answering your question in full detail around inequalities, because we won't be capturing that information at source.
Can you think about how we can get into some of this discussion a bit more with the best data that at least is available to us in future discussion? Chris, did you want to come in?
Yeah, just two points, Chair, if that's okay. So I think through the Provider Collaboration Board that we've been looking at, whilst we focus on the acute elective waits, there are significant elective waits in mental health and getting parity across that. So as a provider collaboration, we're pulling that together so we'll get that transparency across both physical health and mental health, and then that can help, I suppose, provide a wider level of depth to these reports. But also looking at where we might have patients that are on an acute waiting list, waiting long periods of time, that are also engaging in mental health support, be that through for anxiety because of the waiting time, and making sure how we can look together, work in partnership to target that cohort of patients. And then that brings waiting lists down on both sides.
Thank you. Sorry, I'm hogging that with questions. Let me open them more. Jane, please.
Different point, Chair, if that's okay. So under 2.4.18, it talks about theatre transformation, and it says whilst performance is improving, we're below peer and the median. I just wondered why that was. I wanted a bit of an insight into kind of why we're not one of the top performers
using
our theatres, and what we can do about it.
Yeah, I mean, some of it, I would say, is due to just the physical nature of some of the theatres that we've used historically and we've used before. And so there's been, over the last couple of years, there's been a rolling replacement of theatres. So, for example, on the Chorley side, we've got a suite of theatres. There's the Lancashire Ophthalmic Suite, which is replaced a very old work productivity was compromised. So you are seeing our theatre productivity numbers increasing now, and they are. And my expectation is they will be above the national average. So they are improving, but Some of it has been through to staff as well, and the availability of staff, and we've really been compromised in certain pathways because of the availability of staff. That is going to take longer to resolve. But we are as confident as we can be, given the programmes that we've put in place now, that our theatre efficiency will improve. And we are learning, we're picking up on good practice from elsewhere. We've engaged some external support, and we've pulled together a theatre productivity group, which is led by one of our very senior who's chief operating officers, who's going to look at that good practice across all of the providers. So it's something we are focused on. But as I say, it's been historically a product of just the theatre and the physicality, and some of the use of staff conditions.
Is it more one than the other? Is it old theatres or is it more staffing if you had to rank them, which isn't?
I wouldn't like to quote Jane in case I mislead. Certainly we are seeing improvement in our productivity now as a consequence of the new theatres that come on staff. And I am as confident as I can be that those figures and those projections will start re-increasing and continue to increase.
Nabil?
Thank you, Chair. Just on some previous points from the Chair, if I may, relating to waiting lists. Yeah, across the Pennine footprint, at East Lancashire Hospitals Trust, Love Laboratory Health, together with our Population Health Programme, East Lancashire colleagues have actually set up the Pennine Health Equity Alliance. This is an alliance really between all the local partners, including our primary care and wider partners, including academia and our local college. And we've done some work in relation to waiting list by and breaking that down by ethnicity, for example. And we've put some resources in with terms of population health management. We want to grow that over the next 12 months going forward. Really. So there is a work programme identified within the Trust across the panel footprint looking at health equity. And I would recommend really for other parts of the system to come and have a look at some of our early work.
Thank you. Very helpful. Debbie?
I was interested in the outpatient transformation section. It's page 11 of the report, page 55 of the PAC. It talks about the patient-initiated follow-up pathways, peekaboo. And that approach increasing and the impact it can have. And I just wanted a bit of information, really, and assurance about how it fits with safety. So how we sort of identify which types of conditions are most suitable for people, how we make sure that people still feel supported, and if that assessment takes into account their individual circumstances. I'm not sort of generalising, but I'm just thinking of the particular patients with backgrounds, protective characteristics, who would be less likely to get back in touch if they're in people anyway. So how do we sort of consider all of that to make sure it's still safe and
So it's important it's safe, but one of the greatest wastes of patients and their families' time is coming to the patients. And you have to pay for the parking as well. And the fact is, even for cancer patients, some groups of cancer patients, it's been shown that routine follow-up results in patients actually having a worse outcome because they wait to their appointment to be seen. Whereas if they have symptoms, they could return sooner. And this patient-initiated follow-up is something that started off in cancer because the fact is, by not seeing lots of patients at a routine level, you actually create capacity in your clinic so you can see patients very quickly. So when I was an oncologist, and I'm an oncologist, we had a waiting list of, the wait for a patient to be seen was less than 7 days. So, but you're quite right, you need to make sure that you've got the right patients coming through. You need to make sure that they're aware of the fact of doing it this way rather than the old-fashioned way. And of course, there will be patients and families who would prefer to come back on a regular basis. And of course, when they do come back, there's no reason necessary for them to see a consultant. It may be better they're actually seen by a specialist nurse. And that's what I did. So it is about stratifying your patients, making sure they're well aware. It's not a surprise, but the fact is, you're actually better off coming when you need to come. Or else, you know, for having that ready access, the door.
Thank you. David, you want to carry on and take us into the cancer deep dive?
Do you mind if I stand up for this presentation?
Not really, if you wish.
Gives me a chance to kind of,
So,
you move that away?
Right, so we've got a couple of slides, probably about a dozen slides on the cancer deep dive. So if we just move on to the next slide first of all. And we have already discussed at the board the fact that we have had some challenges with our cancer rates. I'm going to describe two issues. One is that we have had a backlog, which we're tackling. And then the second thing we're going to talk about is sustainability of our cancer services going forward and the next steps on that. So the first thing to say is there's this national target, which has been around for many, many years, which Mike Rich has developed, which is around 85% of patients being diagnosed and starting treatment within 62 days of an urgent referral. However, in Lancs and South Cumberland, we haven't delivered that consistently since 2017, much as the rest of the country. And in meetings that I was in with the national team before the COVID pandemic, two areas were a challenge. One was colorectal, and that was around the use of endoscopy, which is a procedure where tubes passed into your mouth or your bottom to find out what's going on in your gut. But also there are issues with urology as well. As we went into COVID, we saw a significant fall for 6 months from April of 2020 through to about September in the number of patients coming forward for an urgent referral. And that's because patients started staying away. They thought that the NHS was busy. However, what we have seen since then, we've seen a significant rise in the number of patients being referred, particularly in colorectal cancer, where some months it's sitting at 140% of what it was, and also for skin cancers. During the COVID pandemic, we had very much the infection prevention control guidelines. We all wore masks. We didn't go into hospitals unless we had to. And we were the amount of procedures we could carry out was significantly reduced because of those controls. And you wouldn't be surprised to know that patients didn't want to come into those hospitals that were full of COVID patients, because they thought the risk was greater than the risk of staying away. Next slide, please. Lovely. So this is our 62-day performance, which we're not being really monitored against the present, but it's just to kind of reflect it here. You can see we sit around about 60%. The Lancs picture, this is the data from September, which is the last validated data. If we were to ask Lancs today, they're sitting at about 40% plus, okay? And that's where we are at the moment. We move on to the next slide. I'm going to be snappy on this one. Okay. You can see this is what we really are being monitored by the national team. And the idea is we've got to get our 62-day backlog, those patients who have waited more than 62 days from their urgent referral, back to that February 2020 baseline, which was 407 patients. And you can see that as we've gone through the year, because it starts back in July over here, you can see the number has crept up and now it's coming back down again. We're currently sitting at 1,300 patients in Lancs and South Cumberland. And why we got that challenge? Where is the challenge? There's two things to cover here. First of all, in the slide on the left-hand side, this covers the cancer pathways. So where are the patients waiting? Waiting in colorectal, and the next biggest one is skin, that's dermatology. Okay, that's where the patients are waiting, very much in the colorectal pathway. And which trusts are they waiting at? Well, there's Lancs teaching here, and then there's East Lancs teaching hospitals as well. Okay, next slide, thank you. So what's been done? So this is very much, again, where we've been working with the providers, we've been working with Maggie's team, with something called the Cancer Alliance, which can help support improvements. So a lot of work's been done, first of all, for the colorectal patients, who do we need to see? Because the fact is that if you've got symptoms of a bowel cancer can be quite vague. And what has been introduced is something called a fecal immunochemistry test. It's a FIT test where you can test someone's poo, want of a better word, and it will tell you if there's likely to be any blood or something in it, which would indicate that they're at a higher risk of having a cancer or not. And if you have if you're negative twice, it is really unlikely that you are likely to have a cancer. And those patients, in fact, the good news is you can say, look, it doesn't appear to be a problem at the moment. And we've been working very closely with GPs to say these patients actually keep an eye on them, but at the moment we probably don't need to see them. We certainly don't need to stick the tube up their bottom. We heard about chatbot, but we've been using that to kind of manage patients who are waiting as well. There's been significant additional capacity in endoscopy, which is really important because that's the way we're going to tackle this backlog at present. So there's additional endoscopy capacity, there's more clinical staff, and particularly at East Lancs and Lancs Teaching Hospitals, where there have been these issues, they have developed their own recovery plans, what they're going to do to make sure that they can be in a position to recover that backlog position. And they're lucky enough to have meetings with the regional team, the national team, Maggie's team, every week, just to kind of make sure that progress is being maintained. However, having said that, when we kind of finally get to the point where we have got to the point where that backlog has improved, and I'll show you it is improving at the moment, we are likely to have to look at a much better pan Lancs and South Cumbria position for how we manage these patients who need to have this particular endoscopy procedure, which is something that Kevin and I were talking about, and which is why Mike Thomas's idea about having binding agreements across the providers is going to be such a helpful step forward. Next slide, please. So this is some graphs. This is data from August of last year coming through almost up to date. Okay, this is data from 2 weeks ago. So you can see the blue line is for lower GI, so at least Lancs, the numbers crept up, and they have developed a trajectory which they did over the summer, and their numbers are coming down. The brown one, by the way, is skin, just to let you know that's also started coming down. If we go to the next slide, this is the Lancs Teaching Hospital colorectal rates, where again they crept up over the early part of the summer, and they are coming down, and we have some more additional data from last week which suggests that they're coming down and they're just over 400 now. So it's the work is being undertaken, the backlog is being cleared. Moving on. Dermatology, I talked about that increased number of referrals of patients who are now coming through. And what we're not alone in seeing an increased number of patients coming through being referred. There's a new way of diagnosing these patients called teledermatology, which basically simply is you take a high resolution picture of the problem and you send it to a dermatologist or an appropriate specialist. And they can often just kind of say, oh, it's this, it's that. Do we need to see the patient? Or if so, do they need to have a biopsy, for example? So it means the patient doesn't move very far, but you do get a resolution of that. So that's being piloted at Lancs Teaching Hospitals at the moment, funded by the Cancer Alliance. There's some mutual aid, and Blackpool have been helping out, for example, as well, which is very helpful, as well as the independent sector. But we're going to have to look at that teledermatology model as we go forward into next year. And here we are, the skin pathway for Lancs Teaching Hospitals. Green line, so the blue line is the actual, the green line was their proposed trajectory. You can see already the numbers are beginning to fall. That was around about 180, it's now down to 140. So again, significant improvements happening there as well. Moving on, recognising that we have members of the board who might be interested, particularly into this, tackling those inequalities. There's a lung health check program, and that's particularly looking at patients who have are at higher risk of developing lung cancer. So that would be people who have been heavy smokers for a number of years, for example. Particularly working at East Lancs and Blackpool with patient stories to encourage people to come along. Drop-ins at local supermarkets, working with lots of local partners, including the local authorities, Calico, the football clubs. Actually, if Blackburn Rovers and Burnley could actually work together, I'm not sure, it's probably separate events. But working really quite closely together, and then with the Asian communities as well, to ensure that we can kind of get the right messages tailored to ensure that we can pick these patients up. And the pickup of early lung cancer is quite significant in this group. We picked a high risk group, and lo and behold, a quick CT scan can determine whether they need to have that. I've mentioned the fit test and the engagement with GPs. Next slide, please. And then again, as we're looking at cancer screening, there's been a lot of work done by the Cancer Alliance focusing on those with learning disabilities and autism to make sure they can benefit from the screening program. There's a technique called cytosponge, which is for patients who have symptoms related to their esophagus or their upper part of their gut, where again, that's an innovative pilot that's taking place. And there's again a lung nodule work taking place at Blackpool. So finally, to sustainability. Here we are. What we really need to do is that we've had a number of services in Lancs and South Cumbria that haven't necessarily been compliant with what the national guidance was for improving outcomes guidance. And that's resulted in some fragility of some of our services. That's, for example, urology, which is dealing with your waterworks and your kidneys. So we really need to kind of think, how are we going to have our specialist services as sustainable? We need to work on our workforce, and we've started that, looking at dealing with our non-surgical oncology workforce. That's the oncologists, the radiotherapists, for example. So we have ideally developed one workforce, and we increase the sustainability, the provision of care to the patients across Lancashire and South Cumbria. But we need to do similar work around how we can ensure we have, for our diagnostics, such as pathology and radiology, we're maxing out the resources we have and flexing them when necessary to ensure the patients and benefits. They get more timely provision of care. We're going to be working with the provider collaborative on that. But we do need to think about in the future, is not for today, future investments in teledermatology and that endoscopy capacity. And as we move forward, what we want to do is ensure that we'll bring something back in Q4 just to give you an update on the progress that we are making.
Thank you. It's a very good presentation, David. Thank you for understanding on that. Thoughts, points, observations, please. Jim, start.
Thank you. Yeah, it was very helpful, and delighted to see all of that. And very pleased at the end to see a cancer plan's going to come back in 4 to 4. I guess the one thing I would ask is, you mentioned about the 62-day wait, so we're hoping to get back to a figure of 470. I think we should be hoping to get to a figure of 0, frankly. And we need to be, I think, more ambitious in setting our targets. 470 is too many. I know there are some pathways which do kind of creep over 62 days anyway. Prostate is kind of a common one. There's a watch and wait bit which people end up being more than that. But we need to be, I think, in the plan that comes back, it needs to address the issues you've got, but it also needs to be ambitious and stretching. And take us into the upper quartile of ICB performance. Not kind of mid-range, which I don't think we're at the moment. You know, the things I've seen previously suggest we're towards the bottom end of ICB performance in this area at the moment. So I guess it's a plea for ambition in the cancer plan.
Agreed. Thank you. Others? Jane.
Thank you, Chair. So there's been another report from one recently about women dying earlier in deprived areas compared with more affluent parts of the country. And I think when we talk about health inequality, we kind of think about certain disadvantaged groups, but I'm not sure we've ever really talked about women's health. And I wonder, as part of this, kind of strategy around cancer diagnosis and treatment, How are we kind of hitting that kind of double whammy of women and deprivation for women for the health system?
And I had a comment as well on cancer, but in response to about women's health, I might not at this stage be able to fully answer the deprivation, but it's a really good question. So again, I think it was just pre the pandemic. There is a national women's health strategy that was developed that, in a way, I think lots of systems, because of COVID and the pandemic, probably haven't been as focused on as they should be. So I've just had a first meeting of a group, and it was quite interesting actually. It was one of our regional colleagues connected me to a GP who'd been chair of a CCG in another system, who's now working in our system, who's really interested in women's health. So we put a call out for interested people, and I've never had so many interested GPs and obstetricians and other experts on a call who are really, really enthusiastic to do something about women's health in Lancashire and South Cumbria. So I can't fully answer it at the moment, Jane, but I suppose what I'm saying is we've agreed to set up a working group to look at the women's health strategy and how we focus on some of those issues. Probably initially a focus on menopause pathways, because that's very pertinent at the moment and there are lots of issues, but to generally look at the women's strategy, and then through that group we can look at how we connect into then things like the cancer pathways. And as part of the review of the clinical care professional leadership model, we are going to have some dedicated sessions for a clinical lead around women's health. So I think we have tackled it.
Great. Very good. Roy, then Jeff, please.
Thanks, Chair. This might seem rather trite in terms of the comments that you've made in terms of cancer, David, but I recall some meetings we've had in the CCGs about cancer and pathways, and we always found that missed appointments was an issue. And when we questioned this, And it rather shocked me, and I think it might do other members of the board, in that this was down sometimes to patient choice. And I can't imagine anyone who had a choice to go to a cancer appointment would miss it through their own particular reasons. But it is a case that happens. And you didn't bring any information on patient appointments to that to presentation. But I think it's something that would be worthwhile looking at. We looked at that, and it probably references Jane's point as well about women's health. We had a specific issue about breast symptomatics in Blackpool, and we managed to refer some of those patients to East Lancashire, who had some capacity within their radiology and radiographers, which helped with that. So I think that's really important when you talked about, you know, the bigger picture in Lancashire and South Cumbria. But I think appointments really important to know, understand perhaps if there are specific issues about appointments, whether we can change that by moving patients if they're able to move. And I take on board the point about that Jane made about deprivation, because obviously people who are in that position perhaps don't have the access to transport or other ways of getting to areas around Manchester, South Cumbria. But I think it's an important point. I think it's perhaps something we could look at in the future and just understand if that is down to those appointments that are being missed. Thanks.
Of course it is. Jeff, then Sarah.
Thank you, Chair. I think there's a myriad of points in the pathway world we could intervene to improve cancer care, isn't there? And David's covered some of the really big stuff that needs to be done at the system level. But I am naturally going to talk about primary care. And I think there's lots of little things that could be done. And I'm sure there's lots of things that I'm not aware of that my colleagues would say could be done. And it's mainly around permissions and making things slicker. So for example, you know, give us direct access to more diagnostics. There's lots of evidence internationally that GPs don't misuse and abuse that access. And it is possible to access some of these tests through things like advice and guidance, but it's a bit clunky and it slows things down for patients and it occupies time that could be used for other things. So I think we could look at all the interactions a patient has with primary care and see how we can make it slicker. I don't think that necessarily costs any more money. I think it just improves the time and the likelihood patients will follow up, because the longer patients wait, the more likely they are to fall off the pathway.
Yeah.
And so I'm not giving an essay on all the things that could be done. I'm saying a plea to let's talk to general practice and say, you know, what are the 10 things that if we did them would make the cancer journey better through primary care.
Thank you. Very good. And Sarah?
Yeah, probably builds on that a little bit. I suppose my observation was around the sustainability of the improvements, because that's the challenge. And, you know, rightly, Jim's raised that we should be very ambitious with this, and it shouldn't be getting down to 400, it should be getting down to zero. And one of the things that really struck me in the presentation was the fit testing, because I thought, I'm sure that was years ago, and I Googled it, and, you know, fit testing became available around 2016-17. So I suppose my comment on that is it that we didn't roll it out, or is it that we did roll it out back then and it hasn't been sustainably kept as a way of managing the demand so that the right patients get referred up to a specialist? Because we focus on the trust a lot in terms of performance, which is right in many ways, but this is a whole pathway. And for the trust to get the performance where it's manageable and it's at a high level, the number of patients being referred in has to be a manageable number of patients referred in. So for me, it was that fit testing stood out for me, because it was that question of, is it that it didn't roll it out, or is it just that we didn't sustain it? And anything we put in has to be a sustainable improvement.
Why not make it accessible in pharmacies?
Well, exactly.
And if it's positive, an automatic referral, yeah. Why do they have to go through another loop to see me?
And similar, the teledermatology, that might be new technology, but I can remember a few years ago in another role, we introduced GPSIs in dermatology, and who were taking photographs that were then getting sent up to the acute clinician. So we were trying to manage the flow in to then manage the cancer pathway. So I think that's the challenge for us, the improvements.
Yeah.
It's small, but it also has to be sustainable. It has to be better than it was, and it has to be sustainable. And that's a whole system challenge, isn't it? Not just the specialist challenge.
Yeah. David, sum up for us, please. Sorry,
if I may, Chair.
Of course you may.
I'd like to raise the issue with regarding some of our additional responsibilities as an ICB that we may get, what we certainly will get from April 2024. which is in relation to the Section 7A Public Health Services. So these are services that are commissioned by HST colleagues, which is the screening and immunisation. That responsibility will devolve down to ICBs in April of 2024. So we've got a great opportunity to actually look at all screening programmes. This is a more direct responsibility. But my point really, other than that particular element, really, there's also some recommendations in relation to that kind of arrangement nationally in terms of health protection responsibilities between vaccination, immunisation, and screening, and whether the two should actually be separated, because and agree what happens with those services going forward. And my final point really would be in relation to population health outcomes, and that would be survival really. What are our survival rates? Are they improving? Are they stable? Are they decreasing? And survivorship for me is the other key issue, which is a support really for survivors of cancer services. We forget, we focus a lot of our time and energy on people actually getting through the actual initial pathway, but we must also concentrate on survivors and support for them as well. Thank you.
So keep those all up. Lovely. Okay then. Ambition, I think you're right. I think we really need to be more ambitious than the 4.7. There is a new national target coming out, which is that 75% of patients should be diagnosed within 28 days of referral, which I think is really important. And of course, if it is the fact you're going to move on to a watch and wait, if you've got a slow-growing prostate cancer, you'll still be picked up within that. So I think we do need to be ambitious. I totally agree with you. We do know about mixed appointments, and I didn't want to point the finger towards patients and their families, partly due to the fact that if you are a patient or a member of a family, and the concern is this might be a cancer, every day is a day too long to wait. So I think, you know, it may be we just need to understand why people are missing appointments, but it's really important. We have got those community diagnostic centres coming on. Steve Bartley announced another 19. They're not all for us, but nevertheless, I think we're going to get a few more in the next few months. So again, we can just think about how we can ensure the access is available to primary care. So you're right, FIT was introduced probably about 5 years ago. It was introduced as a screening test. Now, during the COVID pandemic, we took a screening test and applied it to a different population, which was the symptomatic patients. That's the patients who come along and say, I've got this problem. And so we're taking it and using it a different way. So that's why, in fact, Lancashire South Cumber would be more innovative than any other part of the country in applying the double FIT negative test. We need to make sure that teledermatology is indeed sustainable and available across the whole of the year. And Lancashire South Cumber, we can't have pockets where it's working and pockets where it's not. And finally, to that point around how we think, when screening comes to us, we need to think about that quite hard. But with regard to our mortality rates with cancer, I know certainly across the Northwest, we saw more patients dying with colorectal cancer per period. And that could have been that patients declined to come forward, and it took some time for, unfortunately, they came later. But I think, again, we need to focus on that survivorship. People who survive cancer, they are many tens of thousands of patients out there. We need to think about what the impact of that cancer diagnosis and treatment is going to be.
Thank you, David. Well done. Again, a good presentation always prompts a very rich discussion. We've had that. Thank you very much. Winter surge. Kevin mentioned at the start about the pressures and the demands upon us, both from the service and from above in NHS England. Maggie.
Thanks, David. And again, I'll take the paper as read. And as Kevin alluded to earlier, we're now in our winter reporting time of year, on the 1st of December. And what 7 days it's been, really, because we have not just got our regular, normal, seasonal winter step up, but we are also doing that on the backdrop of this cold snap that we're seeing. And we know that when we see minus temperatures, we see the impact on health in our communities for subsequent weeks. So we've kicked off December with a real sharp cold snap, which will impact on our communities and on health. And with the energy challenges that we're currently seeing in relation to members of our community being able to heat their homes to the usual temperatures at this time, we're also bracing ourselves for the impact, particularly on our frailty and elderly communities. We've also got industrial action that we're contending with, and whilst we're not impacted directly in the December dates for strike action from the RCN, as colleagues are aware, there are subsequent other unions now, Unison, Unite and GMB, who are all announcing different dates, ambulance services for the 21st of December. So our planning around winter isn't just around the seasonal temperatures and seasonal increases in attendances, but we're also having to factor in, particularly in the December industrial action, whilst we're not directly affected, we will be offering mutual aid as it is required for our colleagues in Liverpool who are NHS colleagues who might be more adversely impacted. We've also, we are being encouraged to have plans should we see, like some of our other European neighbours, any disruption to our energy supplies over the winter period. And again, people are seeing this type of information in the both in the news, and I know at home yesterday I had a leaflet through my door telling me what to do should we lose power in Goosner. And I know that there's a leaflet drop that's gone out across other parts of Lancashire and South Cumbria. So there is nothing adverse for me to report in relation to the plans that I've brought here previously around our management of winter, but we've stepped into winter now, and I will keep colleagues updated should things go differently. Our winter system control centre is now operational, and we talked last at the last board around our ability to comply with the 24/7 both clinical, operational and executive supporting rotors to support our colleagues on the front line. I'm really I'm pleased that we've had discussions with both provider collaborative colleagues and with our regional colleagues who regulate our actions in this respect, and we are all satisfied now that we've got a comprehensive and pragmatic approach to providing a 24-hour, 7-day a week response should that be required. I just wanted to hold this the appendix and some of the papers here. A few pages, gosh, it is a few pages, but this is an industry in itself. The monitoring of the investments that we've talked about earlier in the agenda, and also our normal response to winter. We've a finite use amount of people, and we have to, both in our organisation, but in our provider organisations, and myself and Kevin have given a real commitment to try and reduce the burden on those colleagues in relation to how we respond to the industry and the pressures that we see. To send multiple sit reps a day. So I'll pause there, if I may, David, and happy again, all colleagues to take questions.
Okay, I think there's so much in the appendices, we have to note where we're at and the assurance that you give. That this word partial is creeping into our lexicon very significantly in this. I personally find it very unhelpful in an assurance report. What is partial good, or is it? But what does it mean? Does it mean we're nearly there and it's just going to take a bit longer, or does it mean it's something that we can't do? It's not for now, Maggie, but can you think about how we can present that differently?
Me and Lassie.
How we can present that differently next time, please. Okay, thank you. We know where we are. We've now got two important reports. You will have seen the media coverage, at least, of the report of the independent investigation into maternity services at East Kent, and also initially through Panorama programme, the scandal of Edenfield in North Manchester. And Sarah will just take us through now what our requirements are in terms of our response to those two reports and what we've done and what we need to do. Yeah.
So I'll cover both as one, because I'll assume you've read them, and in the interest of time. I mean, I think the report into East Kent really signifies poor care. There's been a number of maternity units that have had a public report, and obviously initially the first one was Morecambe Bay back in 2015, I think that was now, and in a way, and it was actually Dr. Bill Kirkhope that did that report, and he's also written the East Kent report, and he makes comment to the fact, disappointingly, well, what have we learned, because if we'd learned the lessons from his initial investigation into Morecambe Bay, would there have been an East Kent? I think one of the things he does rightly and cleverly in that report is he's tried to prevent some of the issues, slightly different to some of the other national reports. The themes are all similar. And I'm also sorry to have to say there is an ongoing also independent inquiry into Nottingham Hospital's maternity services at the moment. So there will be at least one other national report of maternity services. But I think the thing that really stood out for me in his report this time was he made it really clear that at the fundamental heart of the issues at East Kent, you couldn't explain the issues down to even poor staffing or geography of the unit and things. It came down to the culture. It came down to really poor team working, in particular in that unit between obstetricians and midwives. It came down to some inter-issues within the maternity services, within midwifery. And it came down to a lack of openness on behalf of the organisation and a lack of transparency when it came to learning lessons and sharing those things with patients. And even though this focuses on maternity, he makes the point that that could happen in any service, in any organisation. So in terms of these Kent reports, there was a specific ask out to all Trust Chief Executive Chairs and the ICB, that at the very earliest opportunity, which for us was today, it had to be highlighted and discussed at your public board meeting. What the report is highlighting for members of the board is the actions that came out of it, but more importantly, our response. So we have a local maternity and neonate system, as do all systems. I'm confident that that is a strong forum in Lancashire and South Cumbria. And what we've made sure that we've done as we've set ourselves up as an ICB is the LMNS. So the lead for that is one of my directors. We've also just appointed an associate director for maternity who is an experienced midwife who's actually coming to us from region. She has had an interim period of being the regional midwife. So we've got a very experienced associate director of maternity who's going to support Vanessa, who's our director of children's and maternity. So clearly they work through to me as the accountable executive. But more important, and she was going to ask this, we will make sure that the LMNS reports into our quality committee. So. And the report highlights some of the things they're doing, and Vanessa and Sue will work very closely with all of our heads of maternity across our four trusts that provide maternity services to make sure that we're doing. So, you know, what I can't give you today is assurance where everything's absolutely as it should be. There's an ongoing programme around maternity. I'm confident that I can assure you the necessary systems and processes are in place and working through the LMNS. And I think we've brought the necessary leadership and expertise into the system so that with our providers, we continue to work on that continual improvement around maternity services. And I know, and I'm sure Kevin might want to comment, Kevin McGee, that it's a high, high priority for all of our four trusts who have got maternity services. In terms of the report by the Panorama, I mean, this is slightly different than that. For me, this was abuse. Unfortunately, and you know, we talked a lot today early in the meeting about, you know, positives in the system. Unfortunately, both of these papers are demonstrating how horrific it is when things go wrong within the NHS and the Panorama programme. And I would advise you to watch it if you haven't watched it, because it's another, it's a patient story, it's a way of reminding us why we're here. And if you haven't read the East Kent report, I would strongly advise all members of this board to read the report. But what went on in Greater Manchester was abuse. And it's a very sad thing to sit here and say that as a chief nurse in the system, but it was abuse of very, very vulnerable patients at a time when they should have been safe and protected and cared for in the right way. What the ask straight after that, the clinical director for mental health services wrote out again to all providers and the system to ask for some immediate actions. And the purpose of my paper today was more to assure us as the ICB board that all of our trusts, and it wasn't just an ask of mental health and money disability trusts, it was an ask of all providers, because even though the Panorama focused on inpatients with learning disabilities and or mental health, again, how do we know, how are we confident that isn't happening anywhere? And what I've highlighted is that all of our providers have done those immediate actions, because that's our role as the oversight of the commissioners, is to make sure we're assured that our providers are doing what they need to do. It's not our role to do it, it's our role to have confidence that they're doing it. So what I'm highlighting is that all of our providers have done that, led by the directors of nursing, and I list for you when those papers, which are public papers, have gone to their public boards. And obviously the work within those organisations is also ongoing. Thank you, Chair.
Points, questions, please. Kevin.
I mean, thanks to Sarah for very comprehensive two reports there. And to just follow what Sarah was saying about the board with assurance, not reassurance, assurance. On the maternity issues in East Kent, very detailed reports have gone through to each of the quality committees and the full boards of the providers, detailed action plans, picking up all of the actions that were identified through East Kent. They've all been regulated, and each of the trusts are now working on those action plans in detail. So that board is absolutely in trade. And we're following them point in terms of the Eden field. Again, those reports have been through to each of the boards are cited on them, and the action plan is ever in place and being actioned to absolute site throughout all of the system, from the individual organisations to the ICS and service leadership. So, very confident we've got those actions in place.
Thank you. I've got Jim, then Debbie, then Chris.
Thanks. Just a couple of comments on the maternity report, really. You rightly mentioned the problem with teamwork, so that almost the interface between medics and nurses. And on the committee that's being set up by yourself to oversee this, it's just, I don't mean that to the majority of it. It's a big one. Should there not be an obstetrician as well involved in that process? Should that not, just to make sure we've got a rounded view of the situation, basically. And the second thing is, within the performance report, we haven't seen maternity information. It is obviously top of a national agenda. It feels like we need to see something at this board on maternity services at some point in the not too distant future.
Thank you. Three. Debbie?
Welcome the report and the assurance within it. I think on the maternity services, obviously it has a sort of quality focus, so we need to mind the assurance around quality response to the quality committee. But there's a really important dynamic around patient involvement and what patient experience is in this area. And I think that there's an opportunity and added value to enhance what's there within the performance management framework that Sarah set out for us, with some additional custom activity to make sure that patient experience is captured and accurate at local level for us to be able to inform service improvement as a priority. So we mentioned the national CQC maternity survey complaints, that's great, but could we look at doing something more localised that is trust specific to gather that intelligence? I also know from sort of previous life that there were some local maternity alliance networks that were set up by patients, mums and dads who had experience of service, and they were amazing, really passionate, huge wealth of experience, fantastic feedback, and really invested and worked with the CCGs to develop and support services. It'd be great to see where those networks are they supported, can we gather what they have told us in the past, or can we sort of energise them and bring them into this work?
And Chris?
Just on the GMMH report, I suppose two things really. One, LSCFT as a trust were asked to go and undertake a patient review of patients in the Edenfield Centre, and that was led by our Chief Medical Officer David Burnham, and that's being presented back to GMMH's board. And whilst as a provider, we can never and should never be complacent that this is not happening, I think we have taken as a trust board significant assurance around our quality oversight from ward to board, our clinical leadership from ward and team to board. And there are some metrics that you can, I suppose, from a staffing perspective. So our, within the Northwest, we have the highest care hour per patient for inpatient care. All of our wards would have a minimum of one registered mental health nurse on at any one shift. So there are tangible assurances I think we can take as a board for our main mental health inpatient provider, but never can be complacent.
I see.
I think it's a similar point to the points already made around sort of the use of sort of data and intelligence is a key theme that comes out of the maternity in the unilateral report. And he uses the word finding signals amongst noise. And he talks about, there wasn't a shortage of data, there was a lot of data out there. Mm. But the way the data was presented, and I think we need to be mindful of this, and it's not just for this service, for all our services, where it's presented in the league table, and it gives comfort and assurance that we are doing as good or as bad as other people. So it's really understanding the what's behind that data. So the similar sort of theme of questioning around the performance report, I think all of us needs that need to be inquisitive and ask questions what actually sits underneath that data. The other point, which is clear in the report, that there was loads of information there around staff bullying, harassment, staff survey, the lack of triangulation and early warning. And I think that's just general observation. As we develop our performance frameworks with making data counts, we really need to make that data counts and bring back to this board the early warnings if we can possibly.
Very good point. I'll come back, Sheena, Chair of Baltic Committee, to you after others have discussed. Got Angie, then Lindsay, please.
Thanks very much. I wanted to sort of step back and make a slightly broader comment here. And it's interesting because I was just reading where I live about the local hospital and ICB there and the troubles that they're having. And it came back to this culture where people do not feel confident to whistleblow or to raise concerns. So actually, people aren't doing that. The data's not going to give us the information. So how do we assure ourselves that our leadership and management and our culture is sufficient, that people will raise these things with us and that we will take them seriously and that people raising them feel protected? Because generally, in every example that I've read about the NHS where this goes wrong and people have whistleblowed, they've ended up being dismissed or, you know, we've all seen the ETs that have gone on. So how do we make sure that we're creating the culture that doesn't prevent that? And I see James has got his hand up, so probably, you know, I'm going to stop there because he'll probably fill me in on a lot more detail. But that would be my major concern.
I'll take Lindsay's point and then someone pick up the challenge that Angie doesn't. I'm sorry?
No, I thought I saw your hand up.
It's all right, I'll chair the meeting, James. Sorry, I'm fine. Sorry. I've got Lindsay and then we'll go from there.
Learning disability and whether there was some independence support across the trusts to take part in that review, given that, you know, there are community treatment reviews, there are NHS England and directed safe and well checks earlier this year, so everybody should have had safe and well checks. I'm just wondering whether there's some independent. Do you want me to respond to that now? Yes, please.
So, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I've just given the high level, you know, the ask was to take assurance from the board. But in the background, there's an awful lot of work going on. So, you know, I also have a leader for learning disabilities and autism who oversees the leader work, the clinical treatment reviews, and who works very closely with Chris's teams around learning disabilities and autism. So through those forums, and then, of course, there's the forums that I think are in each place, which are more around engagement with people with learning disability and autism. So we're trying to join all of that together so that we're not just, you know, it's not just Chris's chief nurse who does the assurance within in the organisation. If that's been triangulated then with what our view might be as commissioners or the teams working around it, with them what the lived experience is. So yeah, absolutely, that work's all ongoing. Some of it we've got to strengthen and improve, but that's part of the work. What we're doing is we establish the new teams in the ICB that will then work with Chris's teams and with people with lived experience.
That's good. Thank you.
Yes.
Yeah. James, do you want to come on the whistleblowing point?
Yeah, absolutely. So we, this was a key discussion point that people brought in November a couple of weeks ago. So we launched the RCS Freedom to Speak Up campaign. So we've got James the as the sponsor, myself as the executive, who does quite a good campaign. And part of that is about the ICB Freedom to Speak Up, but also part of it is linking with all the good providers. So we are now establishing a system-wide Freedom to Speak Up campaign, which will involve us, so we've put some resources in there to link into each of the providers But this isn't just a reporting function. What it also does is provide another level as well. So in the event, and I don't see this as something that would be big in number, but in the event that staff would any providers feel that for any reason they couldn't, it's not sufficient enough, the previous report mechanisms within the individual providers, there is an opportunity to utilise the system-wide freedoms we've got approach as well. We'll also be bringing back to the people board and therefore upwards to this board on a quarterly basis, a formal report in terms of freedoms we've got, in terms of lessons learned. So we'll be doing a lot of work in terms of lessons learned, looking at the data in terms of trends, in terms of insight that we can gather. So we're going to be developing a much more robust approach. But what I have got to say is from the work that we've done, actually there's some really good existing freedoms we've got. The providers have some really, really good mechanisms in place. These are robust and working well. This just provides an extra layer on top of that. And it also means that we share share practice across the system.
And Sheena, I'm back to you.
Yeah, so Sarah and I have had a conversation prior to today just to confirm how we're going to make sure we bring maternity reporting through to the Quality Committee, and in particular the work of the LMNS, so that we are able to have that oversight through the Quality Committee and therefore bring the assurance through to board and any escalations if that's required. You'll also see in our Quality Committee report, we did consider the assurance around the stock take of around the issue about the second bit leading field assurance that was required. I think the other thing just wanted to mention was, and we'll bring this back to board as again in the future, is there's now a new patient safety improvement framework that will be in place from September of next year. And I think that's going to be a really important bit, just going back to the cultural piece, is to actually think about how do you come alongside people providing care, people receiving care, and the loved ones, to think very differently about how do you do that patient safety and improvement piece. And I think that will hopefully start to get people thinking about improvement, about thinking about being very confident, about raising concerns and actually being able to do something with those concerns. So that's something that, again, Sarah and I have talked about bringing back to the board, so you've got that oversight and understanding about how that's going to work.
Excellent.
Going forward.
Thank you. I'm very pleased with that. Right. The risk management report, including the proposed strategic objectives and board assurance. I mean, this is a work in progress, isn't it?
At
this stage. I don't know whether we could have a fuller discussion at the next meeting, Sam. I'm in your hands a little bit here. If there's things that we need to sign off. I mean, there's some, again, the discussion with a number of the non-executives about particularly the strategic objectives bit and need for more precision in all of that. What's the best way for us to handle that now at this stage?
Yeah, so I guess we've obviously had some development sessions, but Deborah Atkinson's pulled this together and I think she's in the middle of still having discussions and feedback, as you say, so you're probably right to do that. And I think, you know, obviously we're doing the work now. I did have a conversation with Kevin before the board meeting about the strategic objectives, because I think there is this piece of work we're now doing to take forward the 10-year strategy and 3-year budget. Mm-hmm. So actually this is a transitional year and it's a tool for the board to shape the risks and to make sure that we've got something that shapes the board agendas for now, but it is very much in development. And as you can see, many of the risks aren't even scored yet, but I suppose Deborah wanted to bring it here so we had something at the board that would shape future agendas, and we had a policy we could sign up.
Okay, we know the progress so far. Kevin, about this planning and a more bespoke set of strategic
objectives. I was just going to underline what Sam has just said. We've got some workshops penciled in for next year, around the three-year budget and 10-year plan. Mm-hmm. And I think probably what we should do is build this in to those workshops so that we're considering these issues in the light of the proposed revised strategic objectives, and I think that tidies it nicely, doesn't it?
Yeah, let's handle it in that way.
Just,
yes, Jim.
Just from an audit committee perspective, it just sounds like we've done this for now then. because we need to have some legal advice to be looking at.
Are we content to do that?
Yeah. Does that mean we're approving the policy, David? Because it was for an approval of the policy. I don't think there's a reason not to approve the policy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Done. Thank you. Section 106, monies.
Yeah, so this really, previously CCGs were the statutory consultee for any developments and planning applications, and that has passed to us. So this is really just for us to agree and sign off the policy around section 106. So this is 106 of the Town and Country Planning Act 1919. It basically enables us to access a levy for many developers who are doing major developments that then have an impact on health. So for example, you know, sort of GP practices and other things that might have. It's a bit more difficult with acute trusts and the acute sector, but certainly it allows us to sort of access that through the developers of any sort of building works and properties. So if you were going to get a housing development next to a particular area that then impacted on the GP surgery and list sizes, you can access some funding for that. So it just enables us to do it, and it passes from a previous...
This is from the predecessor authority.
Yeah.
Yes. Is this the same way, Jeff and Roy?
Yeah, same, absolutely.
Okay.
Quite successful, actually, I think. Yeah. We managed to levy quite a bit of money out of the developers.
We can tempt with this. Thank you. The use of the seal.
Biggest issue.
We've used it twice, haven't we? Report back to the board on the use of the seal on two properties to do with vaccination centres. So Kevin and I both signed it up.
You content to? No. Right. Committee reports and updates. Punchy updates, please, on issues relevant to the board. We're still struggling a little bit, particularly in the people board minutes, with the sort of three A's, I think. If we could just have a look at all of this, what's assurance, what's advice, and so on and so forth. David first, please.
So very quickly, just to advise that we the regional team bought through a deep dive in optometry, because we'll be commissioning that service from April of next year, and we will be bringing dentistry through as well as pharmacy. Dentistry, I think, is the biggest concern. I'm not sure how good the provision of dental services is with Lancaster South London. I don't think it's very good. And I think what we would probably do is, once we have that information from the regional team who have been commissioning the services, maybe useful to bring some of that either through a performance report or somewhere, so that we have some understanding of what we are inheriting.
It would be good. Look forward to that. Thank you. Sheena?
Yeah. Assume people have read it, so the only things I just wanted to note was the fact that we did consider the CHC work and how we might bring that forward into the conversation that we're going to have later around the work going forward, that we are getting that clarity around how we work with the patient involvement and advisory committee, and that focus on patient experience through the PIAC and the safety that happens through the quality committee, and that we are really starting to really move forward positively around how we work and thinking about how we really make a difference across the system. Thank you.
Thank you. In Ibby's absence, James, can you talk a bit about the people board paper, please?
Yeah, absolutely. So we had a very active meeting. We had the full membership for the first time, so second meeting, full membership. We did the first staff story, which went down really well, which is a focus on maternity. Lots of issues there in terms of staffing and capacity, so we had a good conversation about that. We received very comprehensive report from the regional team who we've been working with across a full range of metrics, workforce metrics, and we've set those out in there as summary, and we've agreed with the providers now a specific report on levelling up to come back to each committee, so where the response to each of the trends and outlines. We presented the belonging framework, which is the culture framework that we're going to be taking forward now. That was received really well, with lots of support. There's a very detailed action plan that was approved and signed off, which we're taking forward. There was a baseline review against the 10 people functions for ICSs and next steps and a programme for taking that forward. I've mentioned before, we launched the Freedom Speak Up policy and campaign as well, which was launched while we had a video to launch it, and there's a whole comms campaign on that.
Thank you. And Roy, at the previous meeting we've established the Finance and Performance Committee. I think we had a first meeting.
We did have a first meeting, Chair. The inaugural meeting had a number of items on the committee that I'll just refer to. Has to be available as, unfortunately, the meeting was last week and not an opportunity to provide the board with a written publication of this. But just with regards to the terms of reference for the board, we did talk about aligning this group with the Quality Committee that we've referenced earlier in the discussions, and I did offer to have a conversation with the chair to ensure that those performance functions are covered with the relevant committee, just to avoid duplication. We did mention oversight of contracting within this group, and specifically primary care aspect of contracting, and whether we needed this element, whether it should come to this committee or the primary care group. And I think it was agreed that we would have an item at the next agenda, on the next agenda, about contracting per se. We did agree that we would like the chief digital officer to be included within the membership of the group and to be invited to future meetings, and I think that's really relevant in the discussion that we've had on data earlier on. We also agreed that the vice chair of the committee would be Debbie Corcoran, who's here of course with us today. So I just move on to a couple of items that we discussed within the meeting, which was the month 7 position that Sam was helpfully alluded to within this meeting as well. But we did comment that in terms of this reporting, it would be helpful if we had a fuller explanation of the whole of the financial position of the ICB itself and this committee, so we could understand the budget better and what requires further action. I've referenced that we needed an additional agenda item that outlines contracting, and we agreed that we would include a contractor report as a future agenda item. We had a month 6 deep dive and recovery process agenda item, and Stephen Downs provided a report and a presentation on that. Issues on there on the current provider, financial risk, and discussions that were going to take place on the 30th of November with national and regional assurance meeting. I think with Stephen and obviously Sam would be attending along with other colleagues, I think. Talks about the financial assurance framework, and it was commented there that about each trust's audit committee should provide assurance to its board that the finance committee is operating appropriately and is able to rely on the information it receives. So we talked to them again, and we also referenced this in this meeting, Chairman, that was about the approach to performance monitoring and the performance highlight report that we took to this particular committee. We wanted to see, I think, in future reports, a system oversight framework, metrics, and a report on mental health. We wanted to an insight into areas that raise concerns and the committee should be made aware of, and you need to understand the differing variations, again, that we've talked about earlier. We also agreed in the performance highlight report that the executive should have a meeting to discuss how to improve primary care data reporting. Again, I think that's been talked about earlier. And we also agreed an action to undertake a deep dive on either 2 or 3 areas, which could possibly be A&E performance, to understand how the ICB is performance managing and bring back the outcomes of that to the next meeting. We just went on to a forward plan, which would include a contract report on forward planning, and we agreed that future meetings should take place given the urgency, I think, on financial matters that are coming before us, that they should take place on a monthly basis. That's a challenge.
Thank you, Roy. It's a very good start. So, the committees are established. We're starting to work. We're doing the right business, I think, in the right places. What we haven't got quite right yet is this framework, the alert, advise, assure bit. And so this is a developing process for us, but I will set up a discussion with all the committee chairs, Kevin, if that's right, so we can think about how we get that most effective and consistent across the piece. Right. I think that's it in terms of the business. But I've not been notified of any other business. Our next meeting isn't till the 1st of February. Is it really at ICB headquarters? Our next meeting is at the ICB headquarters, Chorley House, Lancashire Business Park, Centurion Way, PR2662. Thank you, everyone, for your attendance and contribution.
Do you want to start part two
today? This meeting now closed. Thank you.